All right. So, welcome everyone. This is the Engineered Expression Workshop, kind of the corollary to the concert we had last night. It was an amazing concert. So thrilled that it came together the way that it did, and really grateful for all of the work that went into making it. So thank you, everyone. I mean, the amount of different styles and approaches and creativity that was going on was really impressive. So, really love that. So, today we're going to get a chance to talk to everyone who performed on the concert last night and really dig into what it's like to perform with instruments like this as a part of your performance practice. Why are we doing it? Learn more details about people's instruments and how they envision creating them and how they compose and perform with them. So there's a lot of really like fascinating details to this. So we do want to dig into that quite a bit today. But before we get started, I wanted to introduce myself and also John Sullivan. So I'm a teacher. I teach music technology at MIT. I do focus a lot on digital performance, ensemble performance, digital musical instrument design. I really like that sort of creative performance aspect of things. And that's been a big thrust of my research for a long time. And co-moderating today's workshop is John Sullivan, who I'll let you introduce yourself, John.
Yeah, thanks. Hi, everyone. Thanks, Ian, for inviting me to be a part of this. I'm really psyched to be here, and really psyched for the conversations we'll have. So I am a primarily a researcher in digital musical instrument design and performance to an extent. My background is all music performance. I played professionally for a number of years, and then eventually sort of transitioned into instrument design and academic research. And so now, for the time being at least, I'm much less involved in actual performance, but my primary research has been around how sort of design and performance go together. In particular, I've studied like user-centered design and different user-driven methodologies of design that inform performance. So I'll give a talk a little bit later and get into a whole lot more depth on that. But yeah, that's all.
One of the things that made me think of John when I started organizing this is he's also done a little bit of research in the adoption of digital musical instruments across different communities. And that's been a sort of I think a really crucial point. You know, people are engaging with digital musical instruments in this way in lots of different places. And part of my goals for this workshop and this concert was to try to show some of that diversity. And I really like that perspective. So we do have a couple of different ways that we're sharing this workshop. It's streaming live on YouTube right now, and there are also people who are sharing our Zoom call, which is fine. Oh, I see. Yes, thanks. And Preston BB is our back channel manager, helping to sort of clarify some stuff. So closing the chat window. Anyways, so there are some people in the Zoom call. You're welcome to ask questions over chat inside of Zoom if you're in the Zoom call. You're welcome to ask questions in chat in YouTube if you're just doing the live stream. And we're gonna have lots of room for questions, lots of room for talk, and so happy to have everyone join us. So I thought before we move into the round table, it might be interesting to talk really briefly about digital musical instruments a little bit more broadly and get an understanding of like some of the different elements that we're going to address through the workshop. Now, this is a little bit of like an engineering perspective that I'm gonna say right now. Well, actually, before I even do that, I did want to show also the schedule for today, just so people can see what to expect. So this is our schedule. We are going to have a roundtable first, which is going to be sort of why and how of DMIs. We're going to hear a little bit more information about people's instruments and why have created them and how their performance practice developed. I'm going to get an interview with Miriam and a presentation by Mariah. We'll take a little break, and then our next roundtable will be the art of digital lutherie. And I don't, you know, this is really just more about the creative process of instrument design and all of the things that go into that. And John will be moderating that. And then Tristan and John will have an interview and presentation. Then our final roundtable at 3:30 around composing and performing with digital instruments. And I think that's actually going to be a really interesting one. We can take a look at what happened last night. How do you structure a performance? How do you create a composition using these kinds of new instruments? There's a lot of questions I have for everyone around that topic. So with that being said, I thought it might be good to get like a little bit of an overall view of DMI. And so this is kind of like a classic example. This is from a PhD dissertation from McGill University. Maybe I should mention that John and I are both did our PhDs at McGill University in the Input Devices and Music Interaction Lab with Marcelo Wanderley. And Mark Marshall did his PhD with Marcelo as well in 2008. So there's a little bit of a connection there, a Montreal connection. So John, did you want to talk a little bit about, give a quick overview of sort of like this kind of model of DMIs?
Yeah, sure. I'd be happy to. So kind of the I guess Marcelo Wanderley is probably the grandfather of the term DMI, maybe. His book with what's his name, Miranda, was sort of the one of the original textbooks about DMI design and sort of theories behind it. So they coined the term digital musical instrument. And at its most fundamental part, it's the idea of kind of three components, one being the DMI being in the box there, component one being the interface or the controller that the performer is interacting with, and the last part being the sound production module, and then the third part being the mapping paradigms between them. So how do you map the physical inputs to the actual sound design? And of course, the really interesting phenomena with digital musical instruments, the definition is digital musical instruments. The digital part infers that the musicking is accomplished through a computer. So because of this, a DMI is not bound by acoustic properties of materials and instruments and things like that. So the interface and the sound production can be totally separated, and therefore that can be a wonderful source of creativity. Or at its worst, it can create a lot of headaches too, because it's pretty obvious with an acoustic instrument why they are designed or shaped in the way that they are. In the digital world, you can really design anything to control anything else. So it's sort of the promise of DMIs, and also a huge part of the conceptual and theoretical dimensions of DMI design. Another thing, and maybe Ian, can I share my screen just for one moment?
Sure.
If I know how to do this easily. Yeah, I'm just going to pop this up. Share. So something that Ian and I had talked a bit about when we were planning this, and I think both of us have referred to in our own theses, dissertations, and also publications, is the idea of sort of levels of control with an instrument. So this model here is one that was put together by Joe Malik and his co-authors. And the model is actually based on an earlier model of interaction by Rasmussen. But anyways, the really basic idea is that you have different performance behaviors and different contexts for performance that sort of go, if you look at this chart, from right to left. So for behaviors, from the right, you have sort of skill-based behaviors, which would be acoustic playing of an instrument, sort of plucking a guitar string or something like that, which is sort of note level. So you go from that skill-based to rule-based to model-based, and you go from sort of note level to much more sort of conceptual modes of performance, where probably a lot of the performances that we saw last night, and in general, maybe a lot of DMI performances that we're familiar with, that tends to be much more over on the left-hand side of the chart there. But I guess to bring this to our attention, that maybe we'll refer back to is different modes of performance in DMIs will address different areas on this chart and even overlap them in different ways. So whereas if you're just building acoustic instruments, you're really concentrating on one side of this model, whereas with DMIs, it's really open and really broad. So yeah, that's what I just wanted to mention there. And yeah, we can move on.
Yeah. You know, I think that it's really interesting to look at those kinds of models. And the thing about these is these models don't like arise and then we choose to use these models. You know, these models are just trying to sort of understand how people interact with things practically. You know, so I think anybody who's working with a digital musical instrument probably is engaging with sort of like the signal and the sort of like rule model, sort of like in different ways. You know, just because that's we're working with computers. Computers are really good at rules. Computers are really good at systems. You know, as well as really good at signals. So it'd be interesting to sort of see how these things play out in everybody's performance practice as we sort of talk through the workshop. So with that, let's go ahead and get started on the actual first workshop, which is this workshop around what are these instruments and why are we using them and how did we why do we choose to use them in our performance? So I thought I would start off and invite everyone to talk a little bit very briefly about the instruments that they used last night. And I'm realizing now that screen sharing seems to break the YouTube live stream, so I'm not going to screen share myself anymore. Feel free when you're talking about your instruments if you want to just like, you know, share a picture or like just like hold one up to the camera. And I'll go first just to give you a sense of what I'm thinking about. So yesterday I used two instruments in the performance. One is one I sort of affectionately call Chester. And this is our little handheld device. It's got a 6-degree motion sensor, an accelerometer, and a gyroscope. It's got 5 buttons, 4 on top and 1 on the side, and then 2 encoders. And then I often will use the buttons to have like 4 different voices, and then when I hold a button down, I'm controlling that voice with the motion sensor, with the motion data. And I can sort of do different combinations of voices, control different voices just by holding down different combinations of buttons. And then the 5th button is like a mode button or like a switch button, which can control different kinds of parameters. And then the other instrument that I used is this one, which is kind of a modular sort of like DIY contraption that I built. Really, and the goal for this is I can make like a module which is encoders or a module which is buttons and slap it on here and then be able to experiment with different kinds of sensors. And this was actually the main interface. I really like these circular sequencers. And so this sequencer is laid out, so it's kind of, if you see like 8 discrete steps, but they kind of overlap in different ways. You can sort of hold your finger at a juncture and sort of like trigger 3 steps at once. And I like this sort of model of sequencing where there's no real clear beginning or end. It's just a circle. And then the 4 touch pads were controlling sort of 4 different voices just in terms of proximity and touch. I was using the software framework that I created for the class for 21M370 digital instrument design. So all of the data from those instruments is going into Python, and all the mapping is being done in Python. And then Pure Data, in a particular software library called Automatonism, is doing the sound processing inside of Pure Data. So that's just to give people a little bit of a sense of the instruments that I used. And I thought I would invite everybody to do something just really quick just to get a little bit of an idea about what your instruments are. And I thought we might go in kind of concert order, if that makes sense. Miriam, you want to chime in?
Sure. I happened to have the interfaces not too far away, but that was not planned at all. But I'm just going to to go get them. I guess the first... So the first one is the spinning tops, and like right now this is just the bottom part of it. During the concert I also have like a top with a handle. So it's quite simple. I just have like a... is it XOSC board, and then I have like just drivers for the LEDs. I have a tiny switch here, but it's just on and off. There's no there's really no control except for like the motion of the top itself during the performance. And the other ones for ballistics, I have the little pendulums on another side. Just a second. And so these ones, so I have like a little hook to attach it to the ceiling with like fish wires. These ones I have some controls on the side, like just an on-off button. But also for this one, I have like a switch that allows me to change to different sections because the pendulum motions are a bit more sensitive. Like I receive attack triggers that are not supposed to more often than when they're top. So I have a switch to make sure that that doesn't happen. And then you can see it's pretty much exactly the same thing as in the tops. But because like the objects are so different, the kind of gestures that I sonify are pretty different. For this one, I have like, yeah, I have the batteries kind of between two PCBs for this one. And I have some LEDs at the bottom, which allow me to do like the beams during that performance. Yeah, so those are the two interfaces that I use. Yeah.
And what do you use for the sound and for the
Oh yeah,
software
that's
side?
true. Yeah, that's true. For soft revolvers, like each of these instruments for me are really tied to the performance itself. So it's like the music and the interface have been thought together, have been created together. So for soft revolvers, I'm using Max, and I'm mostly using sample-based stuff because the idea was to sort of like work with something that was similar to turntablism. Yeah, so it's like all in Max, and it's just sample that I use and modify. And for ballistics, I'm using SuperCollider to receive the data from the interfaces and then like tweak it so that it within the right boundaries, and then I send to synthesizers also inside of SuperCollider.
All right, cool. Cool, thanks. I'm sure we'll get into a lot more detail in your interview and later on. So next, Mariah.
Hello. Yeah, so let me see. I just changed my view, so now I'm switching back to gallery view. So the controller that I'm using is this kind of open glove that I designed originally for a different performance, like the predecessor of this performance, Wezen Gewording. And basically, I have five buttons which are placed exactly where my fingers end when I do my hand like this. And on the top, like on the wrist mounted, there is a little device that's called the SendStage Mini B, which actually, yeah, the first version of that was designed when I was doing a postdoc at Concordia University in Montreal. So this, and that was a collaboration with also the ITMO at McGill University. So that's the link that brings us together, I guess. So on that wireless sensing board, I also have a 9 degrees of freedom sensor. And yeah, basically both hands have the same controller. And actually for this piece, I added these 9 degrees of freedom sensors to it, like compared to how I was using the controller in the previous work, which only used the accelerometer. And then there was a little special thing that during the development of this piece, I noticed that on the right hand, the gyroscope was not working. So the right hand only has 6 degrees of freedom. But this was actually an interesting aspect as well, because it kind of led me to make the choice for this division in what each hand was doing. So this hand, so the left one is mostly just triggering stuff, starting and stopping things by using flicking motions. And the other hand is doing continuous control of sounds. And then the buttons, they control whether I'm recording data into buffers or not, and playing back these buffers and modulating the playback of that. So, and yeah, this buffer recording was inspired by Stein's Lick Machine, which was a software from like the 90s. And I found it interesting to explore that concept and play with play with those concepts in this performance. Software-wise, everything is implemented in SuperCollider for processing the sensor data and connecting it to sound. I have three different instruments which are connected to different poses, like where I start the flicking motion. So I had a low, a mid, and a high pose, which was basically selecting which instruments would start playing. So that's sort of in a nutshell what I was doing in this performance.
And there'll be lots more room more for going in more in depth too. So thanks. Autumn.
Yeah, so I have two main instruments that I was using. I also have gloves because, I mean, I think that's kind of the obvious thing that people go to when you're designing digital instruments. It's like, oh, I'm already moving my hands. How about I turn that into sound? So I have these were initially two separate gloves, but then I combined them to make it easier for the wireless. And it's honestly pretty low tech. I've got four flex sensors that I wear on my left hand, and those I basically trigger or use as gate signals. And then I have a 9 degrees of freedom sensor on my right hand that I use to do the more like, you know, analog sort of control of things. My other instrument, I can't. It's broken down because I specifically designed it to be easy to pack up and move. So this is what it looks like when it's not in performance mode. That's called the drum tree. And when I am feeling fancy, I call it a stochastic rhythm generator. But that basically means that it's a quasi-random, like weighted random rhythm generator. So like it, I can program it. It has five branches, each of which corresponds to a particular drum voice. So like the one at the top is the kick drum. And then I have a couple of like kind of tom sounds, snare and hi-hat. And then I can touch different points along the branch to include more or less of that drum voice in the pattern that's generated. And similarly, I'm using SuperCollider. I have it running on a Raspberry Pi, which is really nice because like all of the computation that I'm using for my sets is actually in the base of the drum tree. I've just got my little Raspberry Pi in there, battery powered, so I don't even have to plug it in. Ease of use was a very important consideration for me. A SuperCollider running on a Raspberry Pi. The drum tree is sample based. The gloves are using SuperCollider synthesizers. And then I also have a sampler that I use to control like vocal samples or whatever that I use in my sets.
So the Raspberry Pi that you use with the gloves is embedded inside the drum tree, right?
Yeah, the drum tree has the receiver for the gloves, the wireless receiver for the gloves, and then it also has the Arduino that actually manages the sensor signals from the drums. They both flow into the same SuperCollider patch on that Raspberry Pi.
So when you're doing like working with the gloves, like developing stuff or like experimenting with different kinds of mappings, do you always use that Raspberry Pi, or do you ever like use like a PC that's not part of the drum tree?
Sometimes I'll use a PC. I can just unplug the receiver from the Raspberry Pi and plug it into my desktop or whatever for development.
It's kind of interesting because as it is, it's like the drum tree and the gloves are the same instrument. There is like a point of connection for both of them where they're both kind of running on this Raspberry Pi that's embedded in the tree.
Yeah.
Cool. So let's keep moving on. And Tristan, let's hear from you.
Hi, I'm Tristan, author and Punisher. Last night, do you guys know how to rotate the camera on an iPhone, or should I just flip it? Whatever, I'll just turn it.
Yeah.
So I used these things called drone machines that I made a long time ago. Some of them are newer. That's too bright. But basically, these are all MIDI controllers that are connected, they each have their own Arduino in it, replacing them now with some faster teensy, because I'm designing some new instruments, and it's a little bit easier to handle the USB to MIDI stuff on the newer teensies. And so all of the software is Ableton Live. So there's really, you're sending out just, you know, class compliant USB MIDI to the computer. So it can just go right into any software, like software VSTs and things like that. So it just shows up as this instrument, that instrument within the drop-down menus on Ableton. This is the, this one's called Rails. So this is like a drum machine. This is the second version of this. I had an earlier version called Linear Actuator, which was much larger and not able to travel with that easily. So this one like fits in a nice little case. So I don't know if you can really see, but there's little buttons. You can't really see those in the videos usually, but there's 8 buttons that kind of, you know, fit where your fingers go. They're nice and sharp, so they leave like little calluses to feel like you're playing guitar. And then there's a linear encoder that reads the position. So these will do nothing except prevent you from slamming it and having metal on metal. This little back, so it's just like in robotics where you need to have wire to kind of carry the wires. That's what that's for. And I have those on all instruments so that the wires don't get tangled. So different combinations of buttons and position are programmed into the Arduino to control different drums triggers. Then I was using, this one is a rack basically of different instruments that I built. They're all 19-inch like rackable devices. You can see I have some standard like faders to control my in-ear mix, and then, you know, a little baby keyboard. But most, you know, this is called the mini rack, and it's the same idea. There's a button, and I don't know, is this pretty dark for you? No, okay. So you can, you press the button, slide it, linear encoders. Same thing. This is a slightly different. It reads rotational position and speed. So there's a rotary encoder for this motion, and then a linear encoder for this motion. This one was kind of tricky to come up with to really get to be able to do both of those things at the same time. And then finally, my microphone, which is it used to have 8 little Electret condenser mics. But those were really, and they were local. They were unidirectional. Here's the other side, so you can see there's nice little old school microphone holes drilled in there. And I switched it to dynamic mic, so I ripped apart a Shure dynamic like head worn microphone and replaced the capsule. So now there's only 4 microphones because 8 is just a little unruly. And that's it.
And you're running everything into Ableton, I think, right?
Running everything into Ableton, so I've got like basically patch bays of like these. I use these like really these USB cables that have the little sheath around them. So because USB is just a huge pain in the butt for touring and stuff, and so these are just to keep everything from not losing connections.
Yeah, and when it connects, like getting it to reconnect can be a real pain.
Yeah, there's like this moment during your set and where it like just.
Yeah.
So for the last 6 years, it's pretty much been like USB babysitting.
So I've got so many questions, of course, which we will have time to get more into. Maybe I'll ask you this real quick. So for the 4 microphones, you got 4 microphone signals going into Ableton, then you're processing them in Ableton separately?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Because I know the idea is that different microphones have different effects on them, right? So you can kind of choose which effect you want by moving your head.
Yeah, and actually probably the performance last night, you know, that was something when I was like in grad school and a little earlier in the process of this type of performance for me, I was using those much more as instruments, like running them through vocoders and kind of moving from microphone to microphone to create beats. You know, you can actually, there's MIDI controllers in another Arduino module for this microphone so that you could, depending on how hard you would blow or how loud you would scream, you could have that control a cymbal swell or something, or a synthesizer, how much distortion was on it. So, but for me, just in these like 35-minute touring performances, it was like, I needed just really, I needed consistent stuff. And that thing was just like, that would just, there was all sorts of problems with it. So it's a little less interesting now. They're just microphones, but it is what it is.
I think that is really interesting though, right? Because it really speaks to the challenges of actually using these instruments in performance. Like sometimes that thing that you think is going to be really amazing just isn't practical for the way that you need to use it. So like you're saying, these condensed sets, like you need them to be really focused and reliable.
Yeah, and you know, I'm totally like respectful of programs like PD that are a little, Max, that are a little bit more advanced. But for me, it was just, there were too many crashes. And it was a little harder to have the sequences running consistently. So I think it's depending on what type of performances you're doing software, you can use different types of software.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think there's, I mean, every software has its place. And I think it's particularly interesting for me too, to think about people who use DAWs as their main software, because you know, SuperCollider, PD, Max, they're all great and they do what they do, but Ableton does what Ableton does in a really amazing way. And that actually makes a lot of sense for a lot of people that Ableton is the tool that they use, right? So how can DMIs work with Ableton directly? And just as even as a MIDI plugin, like the way they use it is masterful and amazing, and you know, it's just great. You know, you don't need to use Max or PD or anything like that to get a really amazing performances. So I think that when we get to talking about performances later on, I'd love to get more into detail about like how do you structure Ableton to be able to play your songs.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be great.
But to sort of like keep focus on sort of the topic for right now, we have maybe another like, you know, 5-7 minutes. Maybe let's open it up just to questions. So this is a lot of really great stuff, and I'm sure we're all like, wait, how? So anybody want to like just chime in and sort of ask for some more details about someone's instrument?
I have a question, something Ian and I, we had talked about, just sort of a general question for all of the performers from last night. And in general, for all of us, because we're all interested in design. One of the fundamental things we were talking about, themes for this initial roundtable is, the initial question was like, why DMIs? Why are we interested in building DMIs? Which I guess is kind of the primary question. But more than that, something that I was sort of interested in is the inverse to that, which is why not already existing instruments? So I don't know if anybody has ideas of, at what point did you find in your process as a musician, I don't like what's out there, it's not working for me, I want to design something else. Yeah, that's the question, I guess. Why not already existing instruments? Yeah, Tristan.
I mean, basically, if you want to be a solo performer, I think I just moved away from wanting to have a drummer. It was really out of need, a necessity. How do I play a rhythm at the same time as playing a melody without having everything be sequenced? That was it. I was like, I started playing beats and rhythms on pad arrays, which is pretty much one of the only ways that you can play drums live from an industry like commercial item. So I'm playing it with my left hand and tapping guitar rhythms on my left hand, and I was like, there's just got to be a better way to do this. That's a little bit more, I'm an engineer. I like machining things. I love the way that knobs feel and the hardware, there's got to be a way to do this. And so it was just simply like, let's come up with a better way to play the drums, in a more physical manner. And then let's come up with a better way to, and the keyboard is still the best thing for me for one hand, but it was completely out of necessity.
Mm-hmm. For being I was thinking person. That watching your performance last night with the drum machine with your hand like that, what stood out to me immediately is like, wow, that's just like perfectly ergonomic. It just like, I've never thought of playing drums like that or, executing rhythms like that. But then just seeing you like that, I'm like, that's like the most natural thing in the world. Your hand is just there. Like, yeah, it seemed like it really works.
It has limitations. I mean, like I luckily I like slow, funeral type music. So, you can't play that fast, So mm-hmm. it works for me, but like there's probably some people that you're not going to play blast beats or, you know, 140 BPM gabber or whatever you want to play. So some people are like, so why don't you play this type of music? Well, I can't, you know.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting too, because the motion suggests a certain pace of drum hits, right? Yeah. Like trying to do like fast drum fills or trying to do beats, like drum beats that are busy. Like it's not so easy to do with that instrument, but I mean, you make it work perfectly, but just the idea that the instrument itself kind of suggests the kinds of rhythms that you might play or the kinds of things you might play.
Yeah, there are limitations. It's definitely kind of, it's caveman drumming. I've learned to sequence things in Ableton. So I play with a click track now, which I've never done. And so you learn where to throw in little pre-recorded sequences so that they don't sound too pre-recorded. Anyway, I've just started doing that in the last few years.
Yeah, and something I totally want to talk more about. I don't think that, you know, there's the things that you, the rhythms that you get with it are totally right. Like everything you do with it is totally right. Right. There's no, you know, reason to sort of like, but that's part of the joy of the, of instrument design is the limitations that it gives you and working within those limitations and making those limitations work for your musical context. And, you know, I think you're such a great example of that.
100%. Yeah.
Anyway, let's just keep open it up and.
Yeah, maybe to also reply to John's question. I think for me, I was interested to basically control different aspects of the sound that I was creating. When I was young, started playing the piano. So that gives you relatively limited control over the kinds of things you can do with texture or with structure of the sound on different scales. I think for me, I tend to develop instruments along with a piece. Which I think is also what Miriam is doing. Like, instruments are created together with the composition. And it's even hard to decide where one starts and where the other ends. I mean, it's in a way the same thing. But of course, I mean, now after having so I started with Wezen Geworden in 2013, and I did performances with these controllers for 5 years, sort of developing the performance along the way. And now I'm actually, yeah, just using these gloves also in different contexts for different pieces, which means I'm reconfiguring how I attach the controller to sound and creating different mappings basically. So that also, yeah, sort of brings the question, like for me, this concept of an instrument as being an object, I find really difficult.
Yeah, absolutely. Sort of one of the big things people are challenging is it's everything. It's mm-hmm. the whole ecosystem of the performance in a way.
Yeah. So in that sense, I mean, one concept that I find appealing is this instrumentality. So with this controller, I can create different instrumentalities to make music with.
Yeah.
Or for music.
So we do have a quick question from YouTube. Naoto is asking, he's curious if anyone does web audio and networking.
I guess I did a little bit, but not enough to respond to, but I mean, like, I'm just going to mention, like, I did a performance with La Turbo Avedon, which is like an artist avatar. So we had a setup during the performance where we had like a network established in the room and like people could connect to the network. But yeah, and we were sending like some media through that network. But yeah, that will be the extent of it, I guess.
You know, Autumn raised the question, like, how are you defining networking? Like, what are we thinking of? I mean, and I think actually the idea too of local area networks, like networking in a room together, which is such a pre-COVID thing versus like a post-COVID thing, which is like networking over the internet. Not that people haven't been doing that for a long time too. I will say actually that I've done a lot of that lately with the laptop ensemble at MIT Family. We've been doing a lot of live coding as well as a lot of we did a performance with the Jamaica Plain Saxophone Quartet recently, where all four saxophone players were at home and they were sending audio, and then laptop ensembles were controlling the audio of the saxophonists in real time. But it's, and it's something I've been thinking more and more about, is what about an instrument where the hardware controller serves web audio files? So you can just like join the network created by your instrument, and then the instrument itself has all of the audio processing embedded within the instrument, and then you just access it through a web browser and then listen to the audio through a web browser. But that's a whole nother topic. But maybe this is a good time to transition to Miriam and learn a little bit more about Miriam's practice. So John, you want to take over?
Yeah, great. Sounds good. So we have about 15 minutes for this, right? And I'll try to keep track of the time, but Ian or anyone else, feel free to chime in if we're going long or anything. And so with me, I think we have Nina and Grace as well, who will kind of co-interview with me. So I'll ask a couple questions, then by all means, both of you as well, please hop in and we can just have a conversation, and anyone else too. With that, Miriam, it's great to meet you. I think maybe we had met two or three or more years past. Mm-hmm. I think maybe around MuTech. But anyways, for the most part, I'm not so familiar with your work. I think I've seen you perform Soft Revolvers a couple times in different things. But anyways, I guess the first thing that I was going to ask, you already talked about, was kind of just the basics of your systems. But the first question that I kind of wanted to ask, just to go a little bit deeper into both of those. So you performed with two systems, right? Ballistics and Soft Revolvers. And when you describe them, they have, you know, the same IMU-based motion sensors in them, and yet they are also kind of deployed in different ways, and even to the point where one uses Max and one uses Super Collider. So I was wondering, maybe just starting with those two instruments, if you can talk a little bit, both conceptually and technically, about the differences between the two instruments and what choices might lead from to one and the other.
Mm-hmm. So I mean, I guess I could start with just like very quickly the genesis of Soft Revolvers, relating to, I guess, like the question we've talked about before, like why did I choose to start playing with those instruments? And like for me, I guess like I was lucky enough to already be in a community where like building instruments was like a thing. And I guess like when I started doing electronic music, it was through with electroacoustic music. So the way to perform the music was like on a mixer and just like playing with the diffusion in a surround system. And that was sort of the classic way of presenting music. And coming from like more of a physical instrumental background, for me, it just made sense like to create instruments. And so for that specific one, like it was very fluid the way that I thought about it. I just wanted to somehow put sensors on spinning tops. And then like I thought about that like to fit, just like as a question of like fitting them inside of a spinning top, the spinning top would have to be quite big. And then like one thing led to another. And in the end, I came up with that design, which is in a way like quite simple. You know, it's like I tried to design some on a wood lathe, you know, to actually put like a big block of acrylic on the wood lathe to get something closer to a spinning top. But this was like kind of the simplest way you can build a spinning top. So you just have like a big disc and then with a little piece of plastic at the bottom. And then, yeah, with the LEDs that go outside, like that's what's more striking about this instrument, I guess, like with the rays that it creates. And then, yeah, so this one, I'm mostly using the gyroscope data, so like the spinning data of it. And it's very stable because like I don't have to account for any other disturbance, contrary to like ballistics, where like, you know, getting a pendulum motion is a bit more tricky in terms of like how to parse the data. But yeah, for Soft Revolvers, I'm getting like very, very clean data on that axis. So I can just like, I mostly map it to like I'm just going like over a bit like how it works, and let me know if I'm going too much out of the topic. Yeah. But yeah, so like a lot of it is based on like samples, and then I have like different thresholds for triggers. So I can control the speed below a certain threshold of speed. So if it goes above it, then it just like plays the sample at a regular speed, for example. And I have like bimodal functions also sometimes. So if I go clockwise, then I have this setup where if you go above a certain threshold, then the sample plays at the normal speed. And then if I go backwards, then I still have all of that like range of being able to play with the speed and doing more like scratching effects. And I guess like one thing that is kind of interesting with that piece also is that like there's no fixed timeline. I just like change the samples with like faster acceleration, and I have memorized the sequence of the different samples, so I know where I am in the whole sequence. And then like sometimes it's like, okay, if two of the tops are in that stage and I switch another one, then all of them will change sections. So it's like a bit interconnected in that way. And at the time I used Max just because it was what was more what I knew best. And then like now I'm much more satisfied working with SuperCollider, and like for doing synthesis also, I feel like it's just like easier to make more complex textures, and like this is my go-to. So if I was to do soft revolvers again, I would probably do it in SuperCollider. And I guess like it fits with the concept of the piece to work with samples, but it's also that like I find that doing complex synthesis in Max is just like too annoying, so I never went that far in it. Whereas with SuperCollider, it's just like that's all I want to do. So yeah, for ballistics, I'm using more the accelerometers than the gyroscope data. I mean, I use it a little bit, like sometimes for like spinning motions, but yeah, it's mostly like the acceleration. And I mean, I'm not an engineer, but like you know, a basic understanding of physics, and then like. You just have to subtract a bit for like the acceleration of gravity, and then like I just figure out a way to sort of take all of the different axes together and just like put them within a range that made sense for the music that I wanted to do. And the one thing that's just kind of interesting maybe is that like I didn't think about that at first, but in certain rooms where the ceilings are just too high, the oscillation is just like too small, so I don't have the same kind of acceleration, so it works only like up to I think 6 meters. Yeah,
That's an interesting constraint. I wouldn't have thought about that, but yeah, of course, the length of the pendulums will depend a lot on the actual physical control output.
Yeah.
For soft revolvers, this is you've been performing it for a few years at this point, right?
Yeah.
Has the sound design evolved over that time, or are you pretty much using the same sounds, or is it something, and this goes with your other works too, is it something that is sort of as you're performing continually in development, or like with soft revolvers, did you kind of fix the sound design and then continue with the same setups? Mm-hmm.
I like to change it every time, most of the time, like, but little things, you know, it's not like the whole piece that I will change. It's just like, okay, I'll try a new software, a synth, sorry. But like for soft revolvers, I would say like that the first period of development was like from 2014 to about 2017. And then in 2017, I did a second version that was like quite different that I played at a couple of festivals. And now, like, I'm like, if I don't play it as much, like, I think I did it 92 times. So it's just like this piece has done its run. But like when I play it, I use like the current, the last state of the software. But like, for example, ballistics, like every time I fix little things that don't work quite as how I wanted to do it. And I guess like I like the fact that it's a process that's always evolving. So like I learn how to play the instrument, and I learn actually what I want the piece to be by performing it, and like that's really live that you know if something will work or not. So I just like constantly update little things, and also it puts me on the edge when I perform to sort of like be with a system that I don't quite know, because that's also like for me to perform, like it's I'm not really on the camp of like preparing everything in advance and like just having like I know that like the energy is more interesting when I'm always like a bit on the edge when I perform. So yeah, I always like update tiny things that makes it like, okay, is it going to crash? But
yeah. Great. Maybe at this point I'll ask if Grace or Nina want to hop in as well and have some questions.
Yeah, I can jump in. So something that I noticed with your performance, I thought your use of lighting was just really fantastic. Just like it looked super beautiful, and it complemented the sound really well. But something that I noticed is that you tend to light your controllers, but you don't light yourself. Any light that ends up on you, any light that ends up on you is coming from the instrument. And based on kind of how your design works, I'm sure that's a very intentional choice. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's like the, it's all the question of like, how do you mix gesture and music for me? Like there's the composer side of it. If you like, you design gestures because of how they're going to affect the sound. And then like the gestures themselves are not like visually part of the performance. Like they're just like a functional add-on. And there's the kind of more like dancer perspective of it. I'm sure that like those, the different paradigms that I'm talking about have been more researched in some papers, but I'm not updated in what's been written. But like, there's also like, if a dancer dances to music, it's more like representing the music that you hear into gestures. Whereas if you're coming more from like an instrumentalist perspective, like your gestures are represented in music. And I guess in my work, I try to sort of like find a balance between the two. Like I choose gestures that represent the kind of music that I want to do. So it's a bit like a back and forth between those. So, but also like I'm still like more of a musician, an operator than a dancer. And what I want to be seen is more like, yeah, the interaction directly with the interface. It's not like my whole body, like I'm not using my gestures in an aesthetic way that much. So yeah, I feel like, you know, for Soft Revolvers, you mostly don't see my head and my body, but you do see like in a regular concert, you really see my hands on the table and you can see like how I'm interacting with the different instruments. So that's kind of the thing that I want to focus on. I don't want it to be too scenographic, because I think like, especially for my purposes, the important point is like the interaction with the instrument, where I am still an instrumentalist. Like for me, it's important that it doesn't become like a dance show for the ones that I've done so far, at least. So yeah, that it's still like I'm still a musician and not like a dancer. Like yeah, I guess the lighting like that makes it more central on the interaction that I do. Yeah. So that it's not too staged, but that's also a balance. Like, I mean, it can be done really well. I don't know if you guys know about the work of like Martin Messier. He's more into the side, like he's playing with also objects and scenography. But yeah, like it's much more like staged. So you get a bit less of the kind of really hands-on, tactile relationship to the instrument, I guess.
So that's a great question and a great answer. We should probably move on to Mariah's presentation. I do want to come back, Miriam, when we get to the third roundtable about composition. Like, it's super interesting to me to hear you talk about your process, and I'm thinking about how polished your pieces are. You know, and I'm thinking about how like you're still thinking of yourself as an instrumentalist, and you're doing such an amazing job of creating like a very well structured, performance. So we'll come back to that though later on. For now, I would love to ask Mariah to take the stage and do a presentation on her work, because she's done a lot of work in a lot of these different areas. And would you like to try and share slides, or shall I do it in OBS?
Let's see if it works first. So,
look
let's
good.
See. And maybe we need a few minutes to see if it works on the stream.
That's correct, too, actually. But I'm optimistic.
I don't know what the lag is. Yeah.
It's pretty long right now. It's like 30 seconds.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll monitor it myself, so don't worry about it.
Yeah. So basically, over the past couple of years, I've been doing research on how to document and how to talk about creating interactive works or creating digital musical instruments. Actually, the research I'm doing is a bit broader than just digital musical instruments, but this talk I will focus on the musical aspects. And that's actually, so the main question that I'm concerned with is the question of mapping, which I tend to take a bit broader than most people, because I try to think about, okay, well, you have an environment with a performer, an audience, there may be other factors like environmental things going on, and you have output media that you want to control. And these can be audio, video, lights, mechatronics, heat, anything you can think of. And these affect the environment again. In music, it's usually a performer who's controlling some sort of musical instrument, which is controlling audio, which is fed back into the environment for the audience to experience, and for the performer also as a feedback. And there may be other factors like haptics to also give information to the performer on the state of the instrument. This question of how these connections are made between gesture and output is often considered like a very sort of arbitrary or personal field. I always like to refer back to Michel Weiswiss, who was one of the pioneers in this field. And in 1999, he wrote somewhere, "The algorithm for the translation of sensor data into music control data is a major artistic area. The definition of these relationships is part of the composition of a piece. Here is where one defines the expression field for the performer, which is of great influence on how the piece will be perceived." So basically what he states is like, well, this is where we're part of the composition, where the artistic expression is taking place. And even though, in the design of these, you're using a lot of more engineering techniques and tools, the choices that you make are motivated by aesthetic concerns. And as I've been doing various case studies, looking at the work of different artists. I discerned there's two main approaches that must be distinguished within music. So this is the instrumental approach, where you have an object which is mainly a fixed construction and consisting of both hardware and software that is used for several performances. And there is a more compositional approach, where the technology is used as an aid to choreograph and compose actions on performers and sonic responses to these actions. And the difference is quite subtle, but I find, especially in the NIME context, the New Interfaces for Musical Expression, the instrumental approach tends to be used as the main aesthetical approach that can be taken, and a lot of times instruments or performances are judged coming from that aesthetical viewpoint, which I think is not a correct way of doing so. So just to go a bit deeper, so the instrumental approach takes an analogy from the acoustic music instrument, where a performer takes actions and the instrument responds with making sound. Usually there's concepts of learning. The performer can learn how to play the instrument, gain skill in mastering this instrument, and the instrument can be used for many different performances and overall functions in the same way. There's a couple of different concepts that that are discussed in the literature. There's the concept of composed instrument from Schnell and others. There's these concepts of instrumentality, which also look a bit further, like where into this question, like where is the instrument, and the concept of musical instrument as an embodiment of musical theory. The compositional approach, the use of the technology tends to be different. It's used as a vehicle to challenge and surprise the performer, or to support a dramaturgical development within a performance, or highlight different aspects of musical practice. And instruments are made for specific performances, and the functioning of these instruments or these technologies is not necessarily consistent throughout the whole performance, but it's rather tied to a score. I think also yesterday we saw different examples in the concert, which also use this compositional approach. I see links to traditions there, like interactive music systems, which were also created to create sort of an improviser to play with an acoustical instrument. Live electronics, where there's acoustical instruments that are used in combination with electronic music, but also these compositional practices where compositions are also a reflection on the social practice of music. And they comment on the relationship between the performer and composer, the physical qualities of a performer, etc. So these are two very different aesthetical approaches, but they do, of course, share a common basis. Similar technologies are used, and in some cases, similar algorithms are used to process data and link them to sound. But these different approaches lead to taking different choices based on these aesthetic starting points. And yeah, as I mentioned before, in the reception and in understanding and evaluating these instruments and performances, you should also use different criteria. So criteria, you should also always judge it within the aimed aesthetics of the artist. So coming to documenting digital musical systems. So the necessity for me comes from, the creation of these instruments is a combination of engineering and artistic skills. As we have seen, these instruments are very individual, sometimes developed for just particular works. And unfortunately, at the moment, the documentation of these works is often limited. In many cases, it's only the implementation itself that is its documentation. Sometimes there's video footage of the instrument being played, but that's about it. And my point of view, I think a shared vocabulary and method of talking about these instruments will help to discuss these types of instruments better, how they operate, compare different works across different types of hardware and software, and also across time. How can we compare instruments that were made in the 90s to instruments that are made now? And that also then allows us to preserve this knowledge for future generations and transfer these insights and skills between artists and generations. And my hope is also that when we can talk about how these instruments are made, we can actually go into much more detail on the aesthetics and discover different styles and genres within the creation of digital musical instruments. So in the process of writing my book, I developed a method to document these things, and I've hosted several workshops with different artists called Mapping My Mapping, And basically in these work sessions, I take 3 or 4 days to really go in depth and analyze the works of the artists that are participating. Starting from like the concept and the context within the work, behind the work, and the context within it was created. Then I do a thorough physical analysis, just writing down and making a chart of all the different physical elements that are involved, like what is the hardware, how are different pieces of hardware connected to each other, what software components play a role, and also within the software, what different processes are taking place. And then once I have the physical analysis, I look at how the signals are flowing through these physical components. So how are different gestures captured? How is that data processed? And how are then connections made to output media? And also what is the representation for the output media? What is the compositional framework? And along the way of writing this down and mapping this, we also discussed the motivations for different choices that were made. And basically I tried to start up a discussion between the artists to talk about the choices that they made and discuss these with each other. And yeah, from the case studies that I found, like a lot of the motivations are aesthetical, also technical, but also very pragmatic. Like, I need to be able to tour with it. It needs to fit within 2 suitcases. It needs to be able to, you need to be able to put it on a plane. There's a lot of pragmatic issues that play a role. So going a bit more in detail on this process, I mean, this is a raw sketch of the different steps in mapping. So you start with a gesture that's captured by sensors, that's processed by different electronic circuits, for example, to digitize it, to bring it into a computational model where there's different processes taking place, and then it goes to output media, which then goes back into the environment and affects the gesture again that is performed next. So going back to these two different aesthetical starting points, so we talked about the instrumental approach and the compositional approach, and also on the level of how gesture can be connected to sonic outputs. One is sort of shaping the performative effort, creating this direct link between gesture and sound. And there's a concept of activation. So to start a sound or stop a sound, and modulation. So change parameters of a sound. And then there's also the shaping of the compositional structure, which is an interaction with a representation of music, like adding or removing elements in the live running score, like adding elements in a loop, in a sequencer, or interacting with the structure of a composition, so which could be modifying the way other gestures are linked to sound. And of course, combinations of those. The instrumental and compositional approaches give different weights to these two aspects. This is a rough overview of a typical computational structure. There's some element that receives data, then there's elements that translate the range of the data to some standardized range, then there's methods for filtering, analyzing, or deriving data, methods for mixing data, so for example, mixing different data streams together or splitting them up, and then there's a stage where connections are made to actual output parameters. there's a process that translates the range then back to a parameter range, so from some abstract range to say like a frequency or an amplitude, and then it goes into the sound output. There's usually a couple of elements on top. It's often quite useful to have a way of viewing the data so you can check what is going on at different moments in this chain. And all of these units, they have different parameters which can be tuned, which determine how the process is actually working. And in a layer on top, there may be also a preset management, which can be part of a score that is changing through these presets. So different techniques that I discern in the different works that I've looked at and generally that are used. So one is range mapping, like how is one range of data transferred to another range. And there's linear and nonlinear methods for that. Then different methods of filtering data, like smoothing, looking at changes, looking at accumulation, higher level future extraction. The use of buttons, it's also, there's a lot of different ways possible how you can use buttons as triggers, as modal controls. You can use combinations of buttons, double click, sequences of pushing buttons, generally using different modes of behaviors based on states and conditions, different ways of mixing and splitting signals, where you can use either explicit or implicit methods in determining how you combine different data sets. But also there's different ways of thinking, like, okay, how do I mix different parameters, different input data streams to control one parameter, like one could set a base value and another one sets a modulation on top of that. And higher level is also to interpolate between different presets of output parameters. Then there's the stage of the output model, where you define your representation of music, which parts of the music you are interacting with, different parameters for control, what time scales these operate at, what ranges these have. And then finally, the compositional structure, which sort of encompasses everything with processes, timeline, how you navigate through these.
I'm going to pop in and probably a good time to wrap up. Yeah. Perfect.
So this is like my last slide, or almost last slide. This is the website where about my book. And I have to thank all these people who collaborated with me to do the case studies and be in the work sessions, and the Creative Industry Fund has been funding my research over the past years.
So I was going to say a lot of what the last, especially the last few slides, reminded me a lot of your book. Mariah's book is still sort of in process, but she's been gracious enough to let us use it for our class, and we've been using it as a reference and readings for the digital instrument design class, and really appreciate it. It's been great. And I think this idea of the compositional instrumental approaches, I think this is going to come back. Again, at the last workshop, when we talk about performing and composing, and even in both of those roundtables we're about to have, really might be a good thing to think about in terms of framing the discussion. So thank you for that. Well, let's take a short break. We're going to reconvene at 2:20 for our next roundtable, but we'll go ahead and turn video off and pause the stream to let everybody take a quick breather. And we'll see you all in just 5 minutes.
Thanks.
Good. Okay. Cool. So yeah, we settled as a topic for the second roundtable about creativity in the art of digital luthery, sort of informally talking about design of instruments as an artistic process in and of itself. And I think Mariah's talk right before this was a perfect lead-in to it, especially this idea of sort of instrumental and compositional approaches to instrument design. So yeah, in terms of a lens to talk about how we design instruments, I think that figures in really strongly, especially in the sort of NIM discourse about, you know, instruments as sort of objects and this dichotomy between a performer and a musical instrument versus, instruments and performers as a larger sort of composition or design of instruments and performance as, you know, the compositional structure. So I guess just to kind of open it up to everybody here is just a sort of general question about how do the musical and artistic ideas shape the instruments that you create, and how do these go together? If anybody wants to have a stab at it.
Sure. I guess it's also like a matter of introduction, but I guess like a thought that's important to keep in mind for me is that any tool, any instrument, like there's nothing that is not connotated. So like even if you decide to use a laptop to perform, like it's still a connotated way of producing music. So like there's no such thing as like removing the interface when you're presenting music. So this is, I guess, like what has driven me to decide which kind of interface I would use. And like in certain cases, I think that like a kind of more invisible interface in terms of like the diffusion system might be the best way to perform a certain piece. It's just like to keep in mind that those decisions are also part of like the creative process, I guess. Yeah.
You know, it's funny you say that, and it reminds me of something that people say so much of the time when people perform with digital instruments is like you're focusing on the technology. But in a weird way, isn't like performing with a laptop like way more focusing on the technology? At least when you're performing with a digital instrument, there's a physical thing, there's that embodied action of sort of like interacting with a physical thing in the world, especially you, Miriam, because you work with physical systems. I don't know. I guess that just sort of pops into my mind.
Yeah, I guess it's all like in the spectrum. Some people who work with a laptop will focus more on technology in certain ways and other ways. But yeah, for me, it's just like this idea that everything is situated. And like, you know, electronic musicians, like right now, I guess like the most common setup would be to use an octatrack and like maybe a modular synth. But like there's like it's always a connotated decision, and you're always part of saying something situated with that, like within a particular culture or so. Yeah, it's just like something to keep in mind, I guess. And I don't have a parti pris. I don't know how to translate that expression, but like I don't, like for me, digital musical instruments are one way to express myself, but it's not like a decision that I will make for every piece. It's just like certain concepts that I have, I think that using those kinds of instruments work better to express like that idea or within that system.
Yeah. Something I'm curious from all of the performers is, it seems, as much as I know about everyone, you're all designing your own instruments. So I'm curious about collaborative practice, if it applies to your own practices or not. Do you often work with other designers and engineers to build your instruments together? And this will also sort of come into my talk that I give about the work that I do, where I'm designing instruments with and for other artists. Do you work with other designers and engineers? And can you talk a little bit about how those processes go?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe I can say a couple of things about that. I think I've worked in different constellations. I've both worked with other artists to create works. I've collaborated several times with for dance performances, where a dancer was wearing different types of sensors, and I was creating systems to capture their movement and then translate that to sound. And in a way, also in that sense, I was also performing with them, controlling that from behind a laptop. But I've also done for my controllers, I did work with a 3D designer, to create the gloves, to create the different ways of mounting. There's a couple of 3D printed elements on there. So I did collaborate with a 3D designer for those things to create different casings. Also, I have some other instruments. I was prepared, so I gathered a couple of instruments that I made. So this is an instrument. It looks sort of weird. This was an instrument that we created at STEIM for disabled people. And just to show what it does. So the idea was that even with very limited movement, you would be able to move it. So this is just very little movement that you need to make. You can wobble this thing. And this was an instrument that we made for people with disabilities to be able to play. So this was a work where we had to create instruments for people with very different abilities. So some people, they just needed to shake something really hard just to release energy. And other people had very limited motor skills, so they needed to have something that could be very sensitive to very small movements. And this was a collaboration with 3-4 people. People focusing on the physical design, people focusing on the sound structures and compositional structures and the I did most of the electronics. So this was a collaboration where we all had different roles to work out different aspects. And that also had a component where we worked with a music therapist to actually go to the place with the caretakers and the people with disabilities to try out the instruments, where we also had to rely on the caretakers of these specific people to give us information like, okay, did they enjoy playing this?
Yeah, that's great. One of the great things about DMI design, not for all of them, but one potentiality of them is the physical aspect. You know, we can design controllers that you know, of sizes and shapes that we want. And so obviously with the performers last night, there was a huge amount of physicality that came through in all of the performances, movement, and then also just, structures, with Tristan's work, and then also Autumn, your work especially has such a striking visual aspect and a lot of engineering behind it to put it all together. So I was wondering if maybe I can ask you, Autumn, just tell us a little bit about the design process to bring not only just the sound and musical elements into focus, but also the entire creative artistic production.
Yeah, for sure. So a lot of the design of my instruments is very sort of baseline practical. Like I make stuff out of whatever materials I have on hand. Like part of the gloves, the part that has the zipper is like cross stitch plastic canvas, because I had that on hand when I was first designing them. Or I use a lot of thermoplastics that are lightweight. Just because, if you're going to be wearing something, you want it to be comfortable. So starting sort of from a position of, well, what's the function? What will make it the most pleasant for me to use it? And like the design of the drum tree, the fact that it's freestanding, that it like sits on a stand and sits up and then it can walk up to it, came out of the fact that I hate having to have a table when I perform. And, you know, it was doing a bunch of noise shows, and everybody is always there with their noise tables, with the array of pedals. And it was like, no, I want to be able to, like, walk up to people and show them and let them see. So, but I think that also, when people ask me my influences, the people that I always go to first are filmmakers, actually. Like, my project 80kv is named after a film called Electric Dragon 80,000 Volts, which is a Japanese cyberpunk movie starring the guy from Ichi the Killer as like a noise rock dude. It's great and everybody should watch it. But yeah, I'm very inspired by like visually striking, like I love Yoshihiro Nishimura, who did Tokyo Gore Police and Meatball Machine, like all of this stuff. It's a little cheesy, but it's fun, right? And that's what I love, and that's what's exciting to me. And so I want people to look at my performances, watch my performances, and like maybe have the kind of experience that they do when they would watch a movie like that. It's like it's cheesy, it's fantastic, it's imaginative. It's I want people to have fun with it.
It brings a smile to your absolutely. Face.
Yeah,
I don't know
I
if
love it.
That's where it came from, but the drum tree, I immediately thought of David Lynch's I forget what it was. It was in Twin Peaks, right? There was like a tree that had, you know, whatever power. So when I saw the drum tree, I was like, oh, it's David Lynch.
Yeah, the drum tree actually predates, because I'm pretty sure that tree only came up in Twin Peaks, The Return, and I built that thing before that.
Oh, wow.
No, I actually, yeah, I love David Lynch. I love, yeah. So it's very, I think that I have a kind of cinematic approach, just because that's what I love. That's what's exciting and fun to me.
Yeah, I also love the sort of backyard look of your performance.
Yeah.
Well, it was a backyard, probably.
It was a backyard. It was my friend's backyard in Glendale. It's like, where can I film? Everything is shut down. I can't do it at school. I just had to improvise and, you know.
So
really added something.
So the thing is that Autumn's the backyard and Tristan's environment that he performed in were beautiful. Like, I mean, they added so much context to the performance in an interesting way. In a way, like, I performed it in the classroom at MIT, and I totally regret that decision. First of all, I had to wear a mask because of MIT policies. And second of all, like, there's no personality there. I much should have done it in my backyard, which I did think about doing. You know, and Otto, I want to make the point too that you started off, John asked you about your design process, and you mentioned that, you know, a lot of it is very pragmatic. And I've started thinking about aesthetics and the things we bring to the systems that we design. And I started thinking, I wonder if sometimes these small decisions, these decisions that aren't even decisions, they're decisions because it's just so embedded in the way that the things that we work with, the materials we have at hand, the things that we know work, that we just make the decisions without even coming, you know, thinking twice about it, have such an important impact on the things we create. And sometimes those larger decisions, the ones you kind of obsess about, like, is this a good idea or a bad idea? Sometimes we give like more weight to those, but sometimes those small decisions can be really impactful.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I mean, I think that breaking out, so I got into instrument design because of Tristan. I saw him perform, and I don't know if he remembers, I like grilled him afterwards. I was like, how does this work? And I went home and bought an Arduino, my first Arduino. And that was because seeing his performance was the first time that I ever questioned this, like, oh, this is the way you play music. You have your keyboard, you have your guitar, you have whatever. And then I saw him, and it was like just this whole new world of possibilities. This like, oh, you don't have to accept that like the things that are already made are the things that you have to use. You can like throw out the book and start with something new. And that's just, that was, I mean, literally life changing.
I think it's like, it's in some, oh, hold on. In some ways it's kind of a freeing experience, to a liberating experience to realize that, because I'm sure you guys have friends that are like this, that are just so obsessed with the gear, and it's almost like their heart sinks every time a piece of new gear is released by a company they like, because they know they have to buy it and then they have to learn to use it. And that's like 6 more months of them not focusing on writing music. They're just going to be tech driven for that whole time. And I think like, you just kind of, you make your own custom setup and you just try to block out the rest of the world.
That brings me to another question that I'm interested around sort of the idea of design as part of the compositional process, and thinking about Stime and Michel Weisfies and his instruments, the hands. I think one of his oft-quoted points of view was, you know, basically to design an instrument, and at a certain point the design and development stops, and then it's a matter of, you know, performing with that instrument, and at maybe mastery is not the right word, but, you know, sort of freezing the design and then, you know, performing with it. So I'm wondering from the artists, you know, how much of your ongoing practice is a matter of continually designing, updating, redesigning, developing new instruments that go along with your performance, and how much is, you know, you've built the instrument that you want, it's frozen, and now you're just really concentrating on the performative aspects of it? Or is it all kind of one and the same running together?
I guess for me it's all over the place. Like I like to, coming back to what we were talking about a bit before, I mean, I have collaborated with different people depending on my time frame. Sometimes I just didn't have time to redesign a little change on the PCB, so I asked my friend to do it for me. But like most of the time I'm very like hands-on involved in like all of the design of the instruments, and I think that that's important for me so that I can make split second decision on like what I want to change before the performance, because like I feel like the technical part is also embedded in my artistic expression. So like I mean, of course I'm not going to like 3D print a new thing 3 minutes before the concert, but I can like I can change a couple of things in the tech before the concert, and I have access to like all of the layers of what that means. Like if I want to change the lights, if I want to change something about the way that an aspect reacts, and I think that that's really important for me to have access to those on the layers compared to have access to like a more meta system. And I mean, it's a bit, it's always difficult because like it's just like you get in a state of chaos, you know. It's just like all the possibilities are always latent all the time, and you can change everything. But I kind of like this idea that like the system is like a co-constitution between the way you interact with it, and then it feeds back to you, and then you feed back into it. And that kind of way of like keeping it like alive is really important to me. And like I really have trouble fixing things and making it like super slick. Like I mean, I very much appreciate that, Ian, you said that my things look slick, but for me it's just like they're all like kind of always kind of a bit messy in the end, and like failure is really possible at every point of the way, and I kind of like that, even though it's not always professional. But I like this aspect of, yeah, like being able to change everything, and like it might crash.
Yeah, something I know Ian and I both have sort of focused on with our dissertation work was about, and it's been mentioned here a couple times as well, is sort of design for professional use. And all of the really sort of basic things that go into that, that are, you know, not especially exciting or that interesting, but just at the end of the day, like if you're performing, especially if you're performing a lot, things just have to work. I guess as a general question, just how does that sort of factor into your design, and how sort of important or how much time is dedicated to, you know, just sort of pragmatic questions of making sure that things work all the time, and how do you address them?
I just want to make like an anecdote comment about that thing. Like, because I'm the one playing my instrument, I think it allows me to make my instrument much less, bulletproof. So like, for example, with ballistics, okay, like if I go over the threshold of the 90 degrees like that, like, you know, the there's like a cutting point where, like, you know, it's like 1.5, and then if I pass the threshold, it's minus 1.5. So, like, I mean, obviously there are ways to fix that, but, like, somehow I just, like, learned to play with that thing that I'm not allowed to pass the threshold. And, like, because I'm the one playing the instrument, it's totally fine, and I just, like, learned to play with it. And, like, yeah, and it's like, also almost comical, because it's something that I'm totally able to fix to make it bulletproof, but somehow it was never a priority.
Yeah, that's so true. Like, the things, like, it's like when you're designing something for yourself, you don't have to worry about all those things, because you have that knowledge inside you about, like, what the limitations are. But when you give your instrument to somebody else, they're going to do things with it that you never, like, thought they were going to do. And, you know, all of a sudden, and especially if you're trying to think, design something either, like, in a professional, like, I'm going to give it to a professional musician to use this, or I'm going to make a commercial product, God forbid. You know, like, all of a sudden, all of these things become really important. Mariah probably has as much experience with this as anyone.
Yeah, so, I mean, the one of the core elements in my performance controller, I do sell commercially. So I do sell it to other artists, and they use it. And generally, I think they're quite happy with it. So, but, yeah, there's quite a few artists who are using it now as a core element also in their artistic practice. So, and actually using, actually being an artist and using these components myself also ensure that I've actually addressed all these problems within performance. So I've encountered all these problems you have as an artist going on stage and using the technology, which is not always the case in all in all sort of tools or the do-it-yourself tools that you get when there's only engineers involved in creating an instrument and putting that on the market. So for me, it's this disadvantage sort of goes both ways. So, like, my artistic practice and engineering of optimizing this device and the software that goes with it allows other artists to build on top of that, and also their feedback on that and working with other artists to see what kind of problems they are running into can feedback into my artistic practice. And on a very practical note, which is I think one of the other questions that I saw in the preparation documents, it's about costs. Also, just having a couple of hundred, I order a couple of hundreds every time I need new stock. So it also means I have these boards ready at hand if I need to. So that actually lowers the threshold for me to say, like, oh, I need another one for creating this instrument. I just have it here. So for me, that's also very practical. In terms of things breaking, or I've had performances where my whole system froze and crashed and Superglider, I don't know, I hit some memory limits of Superglider and it completely crashed. I still haven't found out what is going wrong there. I'm probably hitting some stack limit in the memory somewhere with all the different things that I do. But for that performance, that was fine. It was just because it was a combination of gestural control and live coding, so a crashing interpreter is not that bad, as long as you, and then you can either choose, like, okay, you end the performance or you restart the system and continue playing. So of course, for that you need to be prepared so you can start your setup really fast. That's an important element.
You know, that reminds me of one of my favorite moments of the concert last night was in Tristan's piece. He plays, like, one piece, and then he stops and he, like, walks away, like, picks up a water bottle, gets, like, a drink of water, and then, like, walks over and then, like, gets ready for the next piece. And I thought, that's part of the mark of confidence, is when something needs to happen that's not, strictly speaking, planned part of the performance, no problem. You can do that. And the thing is, digital musicians, especially as people who create their own systems, kind of like what Miriam was talking about, you know the system so well that if something happens, you know what happened, and you can deal with it. Mm-hmm. And you can deal with it, and it's no big deal because you know the system, and you can sort of, you know, go through it. Like when a USB cable comes unplugged, you know, like it's a pain in the butt, but, you know, you can deal with it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You need to go through a lot of problems to sort of know what to do when these things happen. Just soul-crushing errors that you have during sets. If you have enough of them, you just kind of... I always say it's like a goalkeeper. When you let in a goal, you have to just kind of, like, forget about it really quick. Which usually involves a good amount of alcohol at the end of the night, and then you'll forget about it in the morning.
That's one of the joys of living on the edge, is you get the moments where everything comes together in a way you never expected it could be possible, and it's awesome. And then you have the moments where everything, like, goes wrong in ways that you've never seen before, and you just have to be like, all right, I'm going to keep going.
Yeah, no, I've had situations where, things broke very last minute. I don't know. I'm just recalling now one time for a piece that I made called Wind Instrument, which was performed out on a beach. It was a very windy, cold, wet evening in June. summer weather in the Netherlands. And basically for this piece, I'm using also the SenseStage Mini B with a 9 degrees of freedom sensor and other handmade sensors mounted on a kite. But I also had like one controller with one button to be able to navigate through the score of the piece, basically. But then like one wire of this button broke, like got disconnected, and I'm out on the beach. I didn't bring a soldering iron. I was like, oh my God, what do I do? But luckily I could still, because it was the wire connected to the pull-up resistor, so I could still change the configuration and set it to use the digital, like the internal pull-up resistor from the Arduino, from that Mega 328, to read out the button. So it was safe, but it was not. So hiding out in a little tent on this beach, changing this configuration, fixing this problem just before I was letting up the kite, was a bit exciting.
I'm sure, yeah.
Honestly, yeah. It's part of why I wear a mask when I perform, is so that nobody can see my, like, oh shit face if something goes wrong. Am I allowed to swear on this stream? Sorry.
Yeah, cool. No, it's funny. I mean, I'm sure we could spend another hour of just sharing, you know, various stories of crashes and, just all sorts of horrible things going wrong in performance. And also, yeah, just miraculous fixes, a minute or two before a performance with a soldering iron or, you know, deep in code somewhere. I guess it's part and parcel with the with the game here.
Yeah,
I think one thing I learned is not to try and debug a problem during a dance performance. That's something I realized afterwards was not a good idea. even though it didn't stop the performance.
Yeah, that's a subtle one, actually. Like, when do you try to solve a problem versus just kind of soldier on with the problem intact? Because it's sometimes solving the problem can make it so much worse, you know, and take away from the performance. You know, the whole thing about, like, if something goes wrong, you just pretend like everything's perfect. It's like autumn, you wear the mask, something goes wrong, nobody can see the oh shit face, and everybody assumes that it's intentional, right? And if you can pull that off. You should pull that off.
I mean, it's easier when you're making the kind of music that I make. It would be harder if you were, you know, making pop music where everybody knows what it's supposed to sound like.
Yeah, well, yeah. If you're trying to cover a song, that's hard. Well, I think this is time for move in and have a quick chat with Tristan and get in depth on some of his instruments. And actually, so many of the things we talked about in this workshop, I think, are going to keep this particular discussion will keep coming up, so I'm kind of curious to get Tristan's perspective on a couple of those. So if you're not in the discussion with Tristan, maybe good to turn your camera off so we can sort of get focused. So Tristan, I want to do a couple things. First of all, how on earth do you do it? Right? How on earth do you, like, get the awesome, like, the thing that strikes me about your music is how powerful it is and how powerful the sound is. And that's not, I know how hard that is to do, and I know how hard it is to bring controllers into the mix and maintain that level of power. So maybe I thought it might be interesting to start with just with one instrument and kind of like just go through the chain and talk about like the different elements. And I'm sorry, I'm going to get really detailed because I'm a total geek and I'm like really interested in those kinds of details. So like even rails might be a good place to start.
Yeah.
You mentioned this in a linear exponent or a linear encoder.
Encoder.
Right.
Yeah, I use these little basically encoder strips. You can buy them from US Digital. It's a good source just because you can buy a plastic strip that has the gradations on it, the lines. They're a little expensive, but they're plastic. You can just cut them. You can just mount them. And if you look, you probably won't be able to see, but there's a little piece of plastic right here.
Yep.
And then on this unit that slides, there's an encoder underneath here that as you slide it, it's counting from like with the Arduino or whatever you want to use. It's counting from 0 to some number like 100 lines per inch. You know, so
when you say an encoder, you're just basically saying like an LED and a phototransistor or a photodiode or something, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly what you have inside of any motor that you use for robotics, except those are mostly rotary encoders. They usually have these linear encoders on like mills or lathes so that you can know exactly where, you know, you are.
Yeah.
They don't usually put it on the rotary part. They put it on the actual sliding table on the end point.
And is there a limit so that you really know? So, like, so you know when you've reached the end?
No. So the reason I have the encoder is because I want to be able to see how fast I'm going at the end so that you can do touch sensitivity. So, you know, as I get to like right near the end, like let's say maybe this point, then I can count, you know, how fast does it take me to get from this point and this point. So as I'm hitting this, the harder I hit it, the velocity sensitivity will be there.
Yeah.
So in my code, very crude C code, Arduino, then depending on which combination of buttons, like this is the kick drum, and then there's my snare, and then there's my hi-hat, my open hi-hat, my crash, my china, my toms, and if I hold this one down while I'm holding this, when I'm in that zone, I can do like a double hit, like do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. So you can sort of get your blast beats in there if you need them.
Yeah.
And then the back, I do the same thing. Now, you don't have to program and use this instrument in that way. You can program it however you want it. I've tried things like at certain spacings, I'll have a trigger happen so that I can be like, bad idea. Unless you have that haptic feedback, the rhythms are really hard. And I actually made another version of this that had a stylus that went into grooves. And I would print out, I would machine different strips so that the stylus would have like different densities or different grids, or like one of them had like a rough surface and one of them was like sandpaper. So that then that encoder on that stylus would read you could plot out the waveform of what that would look like. Again, incredibly hard to create rhythms. I could create textures, which are fun, but I wasn't able to create that really powerful, like just, you know, through subwoofers, you know, lots of subwoofers.
I mean, what you would think is you'd get like the ratchet, like, and if it's not spaced correctly, it just sounds like a mess.
It did. Yeah. It was very hard to have it spaced right. So I went back to this is like the second of the three that I built. And I went back to this, it's light. I can travel with it. And I was really excited about having a new instrument on the road, and it was just like incredibly, I ended up just using it like this one. So I was like, I just canned it, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes that happens.
Yeah, absolutely. Those are the things you discover because you think it's a good idea. And then in the real world, the physical interaction with an object in the real world is really complex.
Yeah, and it also just looked, it was a joystick. It had a handle that stuck up and then the whole thing was flat.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're on stage, I watched these videos of me, it looked like I was just holding on to this joystick. The reason I think some of those people sitting behind a laptop or a joystick aren't intriguing from the audience is because it's like, you're just going like this. of course, I'm not doing much more, but at least it's this object that's up in the air and people can see it, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Well, there is a totally different physical gravitas to the way that you interact with rails versus a joystick. You know, I guess maybe it's a little bit like that punching motion or that like slamming motion of where it hits the end is so powerful. Even though you're probably not putting a lot of force into it.
The thing about this is if you see there's this kind of like bellows, which is like a camera bellows, and the only reason it does is a lot of times you'll see on like XY stages on mills, this covers up the electronics so that, you know, you don't get dirt in there. And so you can, my dad used to work at a lead screw company. So these things were like, this is a lead screw. And so you can turn, there used to be a knob on here, but I took it off because it added, put me above the 50 pound limit on the airplane. But you can rotate this and slide this whole thing back so that your range is longer. So that you could, you know, if you were going to do kick and then snare, you would be this kind of cyclical motion. If you noticed yesterday, I'm mostly just hitting the front. And maybe it's just because I've gotten lazy over the years. I never used to play it like that.
Huh.
But now I'm just kind of going and just doing that with the different finger motions, which is, I guess, the way that the instruments developed for me, which, again, audience perspective, it doesn't look like you're doing anything. But from my perspective, it's way easier. So,
Yeah, I mean, that's really interesting because, again, this is one of those things where you're thinking bass drum, snare drum, bass drum, snare drum makes a lot of sense. But after performing with it, if that's not what feels good to you or what sort of makes sense from a performance perspective, why would you force yourself to do something that's not right?
Yeah, you wouldn't try to play your guitar in a more difficult way. Although people do, you know, they will play it behind their head. So I guess, yes, you will. You will do things like that.
And the other thing about people who like all downstrokes or all upstrokes, right? Which can be sort of like a bit awkward. But
I do have my little, you know, you do have your little performative gestures that you do. Some of them more embarrassing than others.
So I do want to try to get through sort of like a whole string of things. I guess the point about sensors for industrial applications, there's a whole world of industrial robotics that are sensors and actuators that you can use for instrument design. You don't see a lot of people use them. And for me, I'm always looking for sources for materials, sources for these kinds of things. So it's really cool to see that. I think you said US Digital?
Yeah, US Digital. And, you know, honestly, to tell you the truth, I think you can buy most of these things from Mauser and DigiKey.
Yeah.
US Digital just has a whole bunch of very industrial. They're more expensive because their stuff is packaged. You know, these ones I buy aren't, but I've purchased like packaged rotary encoders that have a metal case on them, and all you have to do is attach a shaft to them. So they're immediately hook that up to an Arduino. They're immediately a pitch bend knob.
Yeah.
You know, industrially strengthened, already encased, will never ever break.
Yeah.
But
part of it is just knowing that these things exist. Like Mauser and DigiKey carry a lot of things that I've got no idea like what they are or no one never.
Yeah, that's
find
a good
them.
Point.
Yeah.
That's a good point. And you know there are there are so many of those other companies and they're slipping my mind right now that sell all the Arduinos and sell the accelerometers and the contact mics and things and a more packageable Spark Fun and things like that.
Yeah.
And they're great. I tend to think that sometimes for touring they're a little bit like you need to package those and to make them robust enough.
Yeah.
And so the industrial stuff, if you can go to a military surplus or industrial surplus store and, you know, get to know the guys there, you know, which can be a little difficult sometimes, and then find that surplus stuff, that can really be a treasure, you know, old military stuff, because that's will never break.
Right.
It's a little fascist, but you know, it is, you know, what it is.
Yeah. Well, military surplus, that whole history is like kind of an interesting history in itself, but
yeah, so, absolutely.
So I wanted to keep tracing through. So in Rails, you got your linear encoder, you got your buttons, you go into an Arduino, you turn them into MIDI signals.
Yep.
And I'm assuming the linear encoder is becoming a CC, or you're just using it to generate note velocities?
I'm creating notes and velocities. Yeah, okay. So mostly just, note on, note off.
Okay.
But for I have pitch bends on these other ones, like on these two that are in these rack that are just basically different, so CC. Or note on, note off.
So in that case, you're probably playing a note on the keyboard, and then whatever note you played on the keyboard is being pitch bent.
Exactly.
Right.
So I mean, note on, and then it's pitch bending down and pitch bending up. And you didn't have to. You don't have to do it that way. You could do it a different way. But for, I found that to be the simplest. I think I was using Reason to begin with on all this stuff, and I really liked that it was such a visual software. You can see the racks.
The pitch bending stuff sounds so amazing, and you use it in such a musical way that it's so satisfying to hear and to see. But let's again stay focused on Rails. So
yep.
we're sending yep. note data to Ableton.
Right.
And I guess actually maybe this is not going to be that interesting. You send note data to Ableton and you're triggering drum samples or something like that.
Yeah, you got a drum rack triggering drum samples. I have done some things where you will control. When I hold down certain buttons, depending on what the pitch of the song is, I will send MIDI back out to the Arduino for BPM so that I can make sure that, you know, some of my like blast beats and things will be in rhythm with the song. That's another one of those things that locked me in a place where it took away a little bit of like freedom in terms of like expression. And I just eventually just stopped doing that. You know, I was like, if I need to do that, there was a certain amount of like getting everything to talk together that starts to limit your performance. Whereas I just decided I was going to sequence some of that stuff that needed to be time sensitive like that.
Yeah.
But it was possible. It worked. But I was like, I just got lazy and said, you know, I'm not going to do that.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting because I guess in Ableton, you could probably do a MIDI effect, like a MIDI doubling effect that you could enable and to do kind of the same thing, or like a MIDI delay. That's that kind of thing that Ableton does, but it's
repeat. Yeah.
But it comes to this question around like, what, when does it start to impede your ability, when does it stop being fun? You know, when does it start being a hassle? When does it start sort of getting in the way? And maybe there's better ways of getting those kinds of effects that don't have that extra level of complication.
Well, that's a great point. And I think one of the things that I sort of have learned over the years and that Ableton's really good at is kind of being your like guitar tech behind the speakers. So like as you're going through a 35 minute performance, I used to be very free about it. And now like I would have a pedal I built my own pedal that had MIDI on and off buttons and about three expression pedals. And so anytime I wanted to change any on and off, mute a channel, switch the pitch range of the keyboard, turn on a delay on a certain part, I had to hit a button. And to keep all that in your head for the amount of variation I wanted in my set, it was just a mess. Or you'd leave something on, or you'd be looking down at the pedal board and you couldn't see it. And so I really started automating that stuff throughout the whole performance. So Ableton, I have MIDI tracks set up. And so I will trigger a scene on the right side and it'll trigger off clips, but they're MIDI clips. So the clip will have an automation for the length of that song with the click track. So as I'm playing, it'll change the pitch range. So on this slider, this is one pitch range for an octave, but on the next song, it's shifted down notes. And it's also changed the sound of it, and it happens on the fly. So I'm still playing everything live, but those things are changing. And I've even gotten to the point where my sustain pedal has been automated. I got rid of sustain pedals for my set. So at certain points when I'm holding out a note, I don't have to hit the sustain pedal. Because sustain pedals just break all the time. And you know, this might be disappointing to some people, but I'm still playing the notes, you know. I find it to be incredibly helpful. I'm so much more involved mentally with the performance.
I mean, I look at you and you're doing so much. You know, the amount of like cognitive bandwidth, right? It's the amount of like effort you're having to go into to balance all these things and do the kind of performance you have. It's amazing to me. So I'm looking at this and I'm just assuming that, you know, I guess I'm assuming that you must be automating some things behind the scenes because it's so much to keep track of. It's really hard.
Yeah. Obviously, the sequences that you hear that I'm playing along with are, you know, those are playing.
Yeah.
And you try to keep those to sort of the things that you're, if I had Autumn set up, I would have like those hands like playing stuff in the background. But
there you go.
Maybe we can collab someday on that.
Well, let's come back and hit on this again at that last roundtable game, because I think that that's the time I'm really curious to see people's workflows in terms of going from song to song, in terms of structuring a set, in terms of what's automated and what's not, and making those decisions about what makes the performance engaging, you know, and what doesn't need to be performed live, I think is a good discussion. But I also want to add in Fred and Alonso and just invite them to chime in and see if you have any questions for Tristan. I'm sorry, your video is suppressed, I think, right now. Let's see if I can fix that.
Sure. I had a quick question about, so like the for the MIT class that we're taking right now, we're designing our own instruments for the final project. And I'm running into an issue where like, I want to sense something that there's not a commercial sensor for. And so I was wondering if there was a type of instrument that you would like to build, but isn't feasible with like modern sensors or today's technology.
Oh man, I'm like, I always tell people that with the kind of setup that I have, people think it's like robotic and futuristic, and but really I'm just like coming up with like a really basic way to just sense my own motion. You know, like I feel like I'm using like Industrial Revolution like technologies. I don't know that there's any sensors. I feel like I'm trying to go backwards and be like more manual.
If anything, I think the mechanical, some of the mechanical dimension of the way you've constructed your instruments are really custom.
Yeah, I don't mean not custom. They're just basically like using, you know, ball bearings. That's what I spend most of my time designing. When I get down to doing the electronics, it's just hook up 10 wires to an Arduino and download some pre-made code off of, you know, some Reddit forums, you know, and program them. But I would say the thing that has been the most difficult for me is really wiring, you know, like, and so what I'm really excited about is the Teensy and the kind of the fact that you can use, you know, Cat 6 cable now for like MIDI 2.0. And so that I'll be able to have power over Ethernet for all my devices. And then my, you know, my rack could even be offstage at a long distance. And so that's very exciting for me. One cable that locks in place, no USB issues. So that's something the MIDI 2.0 that's supposedly coming out, and the Teensy guys are like close to building libraries for it. I'm sure at MIT you guys have like something that I should get, some piece of gear that you can hook me up with somebody. But
you know, MIDI 2.0 is on my to-do list for getting students to implement.
Yeah. Well, that would be that. So for me, that's kind of it. Sensor wise, you know, encoders, buttons, I think that's pretty much like where I'm at.
You know, it's funny because there's only so many ways of sensing things on one hand, you know, and if you take a look, and I think again, industrial applications have people in the industrial world have dealt with sensors for a long time, and they found like the way to do it in for certain kinds of applications. So do you translate the mechanical motion into something that can be sensed, which is I think kind of what you're doing? You're using kind of fairly standard sensors, but you're creating mechanical apparatuses that function physically the way you want them to, and then sensing them using off-the-shelf sensors. And maybe there's a corollary there for if you have a, maybe that's the giant challenge, is turning the physical motion into data. And that's all the sensor does, right? We're trying to be simple. Nobody wants to make a more complicated sensor than you need to.
People want to be very complicated. I was in grad school for art, and every media artist wants, they're just obsessed with technology. Especially in like the day of like, this hasn't the topic we've touched on, but like sustainability and like not making more crap that we don't need to use. And I think like, the gear world is a very complicated world full of a lot of plastic and a lot of crap. And I think, I don't know. I'm kind of excited about not making too many more instruments and like making things that will last for my whole career. And,
Totally.
Yeah.
Alonso, I'll ask, do you want to chime in?
Yeah, I was just wondering in general, What are some of the biggest risks you think you took in designing some of those instruments? Like, is there ever a point where you were just like, I don't know if this is gonna work out with this instrument?
Let's see. I mean, I think I mean, there's definitely been a lot of instruments that I've made that on tour have failed for me. I built these masks that were these kind of mechanical masks, and I was really hoping to sequence some of the motions of the mask like rhythmically with the music, and you know, I actually have one right here, but I was going to show it, but it's basically like a kind of a machined mask, and these have got these little air pistons that I was timing the MIDI with the, as I would scream, the mask would open and close, so it was kind of like a rhythmic, like a delay pedal or a tremolo or physical tremolo, and the microphones and just the amount of feedback and chaos and wires and just, you know, total chaos, you know? It was the whole tour was a disaster. And like, I learned so much about like, you know, trying to make things way overcomplicated for stage. Like I've reduced the amount of complexity so much on stage, and I'm gonna reduce it even more so that I can just focus on making a more evocative like performance, less gear, less wires. So.
Cool.
Interesting, yeah. Awesome.
Well, thank you, Tristan, so much. I feel like I didn't actually get even all the way through the system because I really want to ask about plugins and sound. Maybe we'll get to some of that later on. But for now,
yeah, sure.
We should transition over and take a listen to John has a presentation for us, talking a little bit more about his work.
Great.
Okay, cool. Yeah, all of this is so super interesting. I'd love to just continue to listen to more of Tristan talk. So if it's all right, Ian, I'll go ahead and share my screen. We can do that, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
I'll assume we can.
Sure, yeah, absolutely.
Tell me if not. Share sound. Okay, good, you should see the title slide there. So I just finished my PhD actually last month. So the talk I'll give is pretty academic sort of focused, and I'll just kind of give an overview of what I've done. I saw hands clapping, I thought it was a hand raised, but yeah. PhD done and dusted, finally. It's taken a little while. So I'll give a little overview of the research that I've done. Primarily, I've focused on human-centered design and looked at different methodologies and theories behind that in the DMI design scope. There we go. Okay, there we go. So. In DMI design research, and sort of, I'll probably mention NIME more than a few times. So NIME is the New Interfaces for Musical Expression Conference, and more generally, sort of the NIME community, of which we're probably all pretty well familiar with. So, you know, obviously, DMI design research focuses on, you know, new instruments, and there's a wide variety of different. You know, shapes, sizes, uses, things like that. Versus more widespread professional performance practices with digital technologies. So what we find is in the NIME or DMI design sphere, there's a lot of ingenuity and creative design and stuff. When it comes to professional performance, we see a lot of the same controllers and shapes and uses repeated. Things like piano keyboards, grid style controllers, DJ tools like digital turntables, mixers, things like that. So my inquiry was kind of, where is this divide and what is sort of missing between the two? So a couple things that I've looked into and sort of as a way of explaining these dichotomies, we find that DMI use is constrained to a more narrow context of experimental musical styles. McPherson and Kim talked about the problem of the second performer, where a lot of new DMIs are made, but typically they're sort of bespoke instruments where people are designing instruments for their own use and not necessarily for other musicians to use. And then also something that we've already talked about a bit that I've done some of my own research in is really addressing specific demands of active and professional performance in design, especially pragmatic issues just about how to design robust instruments that can stand up to professional use. Where I come from in my research interest is I'm a musician by trade. I got a degree in jazz performance originally, in composition. I played professionally for a decade or so. I toured a lot. This is me back there. I'm primarily a bass player, but also was sort of a multi-instrumentalist. And then I started touring as a multi-instrumentalist, and that got me into using a more bass system and a lot of different controllers, and then flying and traveling with a lot of different instruments and figuring out ways that I could pare down a system. And that sort of got me into designing my own interfaces and scripting and automating certain features of performance. This has turned into the sort of research scope that focuses on human-computer interaction, human-centered design, and applying what I know of my own experience as a performer to designing new instruments. My thesis research was based around three sort of questions. One was to understand how active and professional musicians use new instruments, and especially to understand different diverse communities, both in experimental practice, but also in more widespread popular performance. And then from the design standpoint, how can designers leverage knowledge of performers, and what sort of methodologies and activities can we use in the design process to basically overall to design instruments that work for performers? And I guess the third aspect was looking closely at theories and methods for collaborative design. So these were all sort of oriented around these three different projects that I'll speak kind of briefly about. So the first thing that I did was I conducted a survey of musicians. I've actually done a couple of these. This focuses on the more recent one. So surveys have been used in, especially in NIM community before. So that in itself is nothing new. However, there has kind of been a lack of research on more widespread and popular performance with technology, which is something that I wanted to address. And another aspect that I found really interesting that we have also sort of touched on here is in NIM, and also I think for the artists here, design and performance overlaps a lot. It's oftentimes one individual doing both the design and the creative practice. For the majority of professional musicians and performers, though, they're not actually designing their own instruments that they use. So the survey sort of looked at that a little bit more too. How do professional performers use technologies that maybe they haven't designed themselves? What are some of the differences? The survey went out. We had, I think, around 100 responses. It was mostly qualitative, a lot of open-ended answers that were then analyzed. And the results were sort of condensed down into three sort of aspects. We identified several general desirable qualities of digital musical instruments. We looked at specific factors that influence the uptake, continued use, and also retirement of new technologies. And then finally, did some additional analysis based on theories of user engagement, both for short-term and long-term user engagement, to understand how, you know, the results of the survey map onto existing theories from literature. So I won't go into too much about the specifics about it, but basically overall this was meant to give a basic background and understanding of, you know, who's using DMIs, how they're being used, and use this for a sort of launch pad for applied design studies. The second project that I'll talk about a little bit was a workshop or a series of workshops that I did called the Design for Performance Workshops. So this was sort of looking at, you know, how do we sort of generate new ideas for designing instruments? How do we apply human-centered design and participatory design methods? And mostly focusing on co-design of instruments. So co-designing with expert musicians. The background for the workshop comes from two places, but actually sort of overlapped. One is the idea of design fiction, where basically concepts and problems can be explored through creating imaginary scenarios and fantasy prototypes, as Sterling referred to them. And then the actual mechanics, the methodology that I used was very much based on the work of Christina Anderson in her Magic Machine workshops, where the design activities are based not so much on creating new design artifacts or new design prototypes, but basically using this and applying design fiction to use the artifacts to explore this problem space. So I conducted two workshops, two of the same workshops, where we brought in expert musicians and went through these five activities. So the first thing was a design prompt where the musicians were asked to draw the music that they imagined they would like to make with some instruments that they would want to design. It was sort of a design prompt just to sort of, you know, start the creative process and allow them to sort of think creatively, but also just sort of in a fiction of their own design. And then this was followed by a non-functional prototyping activity where they could craft the imaginary instruments that would play the music that they wanted to play. So there was a bunch of crafting materials that were provided, things like poster boards, sticks, tape, cups, things like that. And sorry about that. So that was activity number two. That was kind of the main activity, after which the participants would present their instruments, give a demonstration, discuss with the group about how they would play. And then finally, as a group, we sort of broke down the different designs, identified common elements of the designs, prioritized important parts, less important parts, and through that sort of discuss about how a lot of these elements could be put together and worked into actual tangible functional musical instruments. So out of this, out of the in-workshop activities and then analysis of the presentations after the fact, we came up with a list of design specifications. So the five main specifications that we came up with were these. Number one, to prioritize embodied physical and material oriented interactions. Utilize flexible signal routing and mapping paradigms. Focus on instruments that have multiple modes or modules of operation. integrate a wide variety of audio inputs and signal routing, again, for flexible operation and flexible sound design. And then finally, to mix familiar and novel elements of existing instruments and then new elements as well together. So from these design specifications, I applied them to some instruments that, a series of instruments that I've been designing for over the last few years. They're called noise boxes. I generally had started designing these as just sort of practice-based research on DMI design. These are standalone embedded musical instruments. I've used a variety of different internal technologies, but basically they run off either a Raspberry Pi and Arduinos, or other newer versions have also used the Bella system for embedded instruments. But they're self-contained. The original idea was that they would have some, you know, some features analogous to acoustic instruments, such as, you know, they're handheld, they're immediately playable, onboard sound production, and direct output, and things like that. So these are some of the older designs that I had used. And the new ones that came out of the workshop design specifications were these three. So the first was a Keybox, which is a handheld subtractive synthesizer with various modes of functioning for sampling, looping, effects manipulation, a variety of controls and layouts, and also some motion control mapping to it as well. The second was a string box, which is sort of a hybrid guitar style controller. You can't see it too well, but there are actually four strings on the top and then this grid controller on the side. So it can be played as a, you know, sort of a guitar or ukulele, but then also can be switched to an alternate mode where it functions as a sequencer. Then the final instrument was a tap box, which is sort of a handheld digital cajon, where each surface of the instrument is a sort of a floating panel with a piezoelectric pickup mounted underneath it. So each one is mapped to a different synthesis algorithm, and it's also mapped to motion and orientation. So if it's flipped over one way, it sort of functions as a drum machine. If you flip it over the other way, it has a physical synthesis algorithm mapped to it. So you can sort of play back and forth between those. Each one of these instruments, I won't go into detail, but for examples, has different design specifications sort of embedded in. Finally, the third project that I'll mention here was focused on collaborative DMI design. This was a couple of different studies that I did with a good friend and collaborator of mine, Alex Tibbetts. She's a harpist here in Montreal. She focuses on contemporary and experimental harp performance. So whereas the previous project sort of focused on collaborating with a number of expert musicians, where we sort of remixed all of their ideas into a few instruments, this was working sort of one-to-one with a musician and designing bespoke instruments that would really speak to her needs specifically. The first study we did was focused on gestural control of instrumental performance and went through a few stages. First, we conducted a motion capture study of harp performance, and we're really interested in how can we use some of the natural motions of instrumental performance, how can we map those to a digital musical system. So from the motion capture study, we basically created a vocabulary of movement that then we could apply to composition. We developed some basic hardware controllers and a software interface that could directly integrate into her performance system. So using primarily Macs and then also Macs for Live, We developed a couple different interfaces that she could just directly drop into her pre-existing performance and use these natural motions in her performance. Finally, with a composer, colleague of ours, Brice Gatineau, we worked together. He composed a piece that was performed a few different times. So the second performance was one more recent. The project is called The Bionic Harpist. And based on our previous experience, we had some immediate specifications that we wanted to address with the new designs. One was we wanted to design physical controllers this time to augment her instrument, focus on simple configuration for performance. We wanted to design a system that was non-permanent and could be removable and actually moved from instrument to instrument if she was touring, and make this whole system ergonomic and non-invasive so she could also play her harp as an acoustic instrument, but also be able to leverage, you know, additional controls. This was based on participatory design methods. Especially in the prototyping phase, we used a wide variety of techniques. CAD design was a big part of it, and sort of rapid prototyping on multiple different levels, from, you know, paper sketches that we could dump immediately into CAD. Also used TouchOSC to design instant layouts, functional layouts too, that were already mapped to her performance software, so we could test things out in real time. We also used some of the same non-functional prototyping techniques that had come from the workshops, basic cardboard techniques that would help us design, you know, sort of ergonomics of the controllers. And then, of course, more CAD, where we could develop actually pretty high fidelity models. And when it came time to actually build these interfaces, they all came together very easily because we already had the CAD designs all ready to go. So it was just a matter of, you know, printing, laser cutting, and, you know, basically snapping the electronics together, and they were all ready to go. So these are the finished controllers that we designed. These were prepared for MuTech last year. And so they just sort of fit on the two sides of the strings with her harp and give her access to, you know, a bunch of parameters. For this setup, she has everything mapped in Ableton Live. And at the end of the day, these are just wireless MIDI controllers. We opted for that instead of the previous project where it was actually wirelessly sending OSC. This is all wireless MIDI. So it was just instant connection, really, really easy to configure, that worked well for her performance. So now this is sort of her general setup. She's been using it professionally now for several performances. Here's a short clip here of her last MuTech performance. So I'll be honest, I'm not sure exactly how much time I have left, but I assume I'm probably right around the end. So I'll just sort of wrap up. How am I doing, Ian?
Yeah, you should probably wrap up.
Okay, perfect. That was basically it. The idea was, you know, understand the background, who's using what, and then design some methods to sort of explore this in participatory and collaborative design projects. So yeah, I'll leave it off from that and we can move on. Thanks.
Cool. Well, thanks, John. Well, let's go ahead and take a couple of minute break and reconvene at 3:40 and have our final roundtable. So we'll see you all just in a few minutes. So we're back and sort of in our last roundtable. And I thought I would start off, Tristan, we were talking a little bit about your performance setup and you were sort of saying how you've been using Ableton to try to automate things behind the scenes a little bit to try to simplify the performance process.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, to me, this is really practical. Like, in a way, I was thinking about John talking about the Alex Tibbetts project. It's like the performance is the crucible. You know, it's the thing that, you know, where you have to, you know, you need to make the performance successful. And so you're really going to focus on the things that work, right? And I think that on a very practical level, I think that's really important. But also it shapes the way that you structure your performance, right? Like what works musically as well as what works technically.
Right.
So Tristan, we got a good sense of you working with Ableton. Miriam, I'd be curious to learn a little bit more. I think we got a little bit of sense of you working in Max and Super Collider. Are you working with a timeline or with any kind of like behind the scenes structure that you're navigating through?
I usually have some kind of canvas. So like, I guess it takes the form of different sections, but usually it's more like a sequence instrument per instrument rather than like an overall switch section thing. So like I design a sequence of different mappings for each instrument. Like because I work a lot with as you saw, like objects that already have autonomous behaviors, like the spinning tops. When I put them in motion, they have a motion of their own, and I think that's really successful for me to, yeah, like kind of let go of some of the control and have some part of the musical energy be fed by the system itself rather than just by my movements. So I tend, yes, to have like each instrument has a sequence of different presets, let's say, like a state of where the mapping is. And I navigate through that by different types of more like trigger types of motions. So I think this is something that Maria also mentioned in her presentation, like the difference between like a trigger kind of motion and a modulation kind of motion. So in Soft Revolvers, like I switch to the next sequence item by doing like a faster acceleration, which happens naturally when I start a spinning motion, but also sometimes like I will, like I've come to integrate those into the way that I play with them by just like doing faster motions and like skipping motions, which allow me to pass to the next one. With these ones, I mean, it's a bit the same thing. Like sometimes I will do more kind of a trigger attack type of motion, but I already, as I said, like have a button, just like a safeguard, so that like for major or for like dramatic sections of the piece where like there's a very clear change, like for example in Ballistics, there's a moment where like the parameters change dramatically. Like I go like this, and then it's like the last moment, and then I throw this one, and then it has to change sections for all of the instruments. So just to make sure that progression works well for Ballistics, I've added a little button that allows me to enable the next. So it doesn't change the section, just the button, but it allows me that the next time I do a flick, it will go to the next one. So I guess it's kind of this hybrid canvas that allows me to stay as long as I want within a section, but at the same time to have some kind of predefined form that I will go through. And yeah, and most times when I work with very gestural controllers, this is kind of the type of canvas that I've been working with.
Yeah. I mean, that way of the trigger to go to the next section being a part of the actual gestural interaction with the device. In one sense, it feels risky, right? Because it means that you really have to be aware that you're not going to trigger the next stage prematurely. So the idea of having a safeguard makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, but
it's also very natural.
Yeah, but it's like, to be honest, I'm really happy with Soft Revolvers that I don't have that other trigger. Because like in this one, like, I mean, I've worked to make it seamless, but still like going to the button and hitting it, I notice at least that it changes a bit my interaction with it. So I would prefer if it was completely like from gestures that I also use as a performance gesture, whereas mm-hmm. like, you know, pressing that button is really just functional. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people who work more with tabletops will have like a pedal that's hidden to do that kind of safeguarding that it doesn't go the wrong way. But yeah, I mean, for self-revolvers, I just like have developed a kind of like sixth sense of like where I am in the structure, and I know it very well, so I can play around with that.
Yeah, I mean, that's, I mean, you said sixth sense, I was gonna say knowledge.
Yeah.
You know, like kind of like a personal knowledge of what's going on with the instrument and when you're gonna trigger a new section. And
yeah, but what I meant, it's like it becomes kind of preconscious. Like it's not, yeah. I don't consciously count where I am, but like I've done it enough that it's just like,
yeah. It makes me think a lot of Mariah's sort of talking about compositional versus instrumental approaches to instrument design. I mean, so when you were hearing where I talk about the, do you feel like you're more of a compositional approach rather than instrumental approach?
We've had that discussion together a couple of times actually, but I mean this is something that you know, I've had more of a career outside of academia, but you know, when I was doing my master's, I've come across a lot of articles from NIME, and this is something that I had trouble with, like the more, I mean, it's part of it, like there's an engineering aspect, but this idea that an instrument should be used in all pieces, that's something that never resonated with me. Yeah, because that's not, like, I mean, I think I would be more interested right now to design controllers that we'll use to compose or to perform where the visual is not as important. But if you're going to do a DMI where the gestural aspect is important, where the visual aspect is put in focus, I think that it makes sense, at least to me, it resonates more when the design itself is tied to the composition.
Yeah. I mean, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah. I mean, you can only really do so much on something. You have to focus on something. And if that's your focus, it makes sense as being a constraint. I think a lot about Jeff Carey's control keys lately. And one of the things that Jeff Carey talks about, this is a case study in Mariah's book, is every time he adds a new function to his controller, he still has to be able to play his old compositions. And like the burden of that, but also like nobody else would, I can't imagine anybody else would be able to play his composition, his instrument the way he does, because he's got it so overloaded. But I don't know, that's not a bad thing. That's, again, this is part of a knowledge, this is part of practice, right? It's like your personal instrument. So, you know, Miriam knows when she plays with soft revolvers exactly where she is in the piece, but anybody else playing soft revolvers, how would they know? Right, they would have to go through the process of building up the performance practice that you have. So how about you, Mariah? So when your piece on the concert, what was the structure for that and how were you navigating through it?
So actually, in this piece, I didn't pre-implement any structure into the software. Except that there were like these instruments I could start and stop that were directly controlled, and that I was able to record motion data and play it back. So these were like the main sort of layers that I could play with. And then, I mean, my compositional structure was just sort of thinking up like, okay, how am I going to build up playing with this? So I did sort of sketch something out on paper as a sort of first guideline. Okay, how am I gonna build up a structure, musical structure, and then just play it? I think, and then basically I just started rehearsing. So I spent quite a lot of time to make like in the development of this piece. It was very condensed. I mean, I had all these little building blocks that I had developed before, but then I put it all together for this performance in a very short time. So I spent some time working out the framework, make sure that everything was working, like in a technical sense. And then basically I moved to a different space than my desk here and started playing and sort of thinking about what's the compositional structure would be, and then basically I moved into the space and played on a big system, and yeah, I rehearsed a couple of more times, and yeah, the video that you saw was the fourth take of the recording, so that was like the fifth or the sixth time that day that I played the piece in that space. So yeah, the structure in that sense sort of evolved during playing.
So I'm curious, if you were to have like done like an hour-long performance or something like that, how would you have managed? I mean, I guess I'll say for me, myself personally, like I would probably think about changing mappings or thinking about like, you know, somehow altering the software state of the instrument to sort of give to access to a broader palette than just the one kind of couple of palettes I was working with.
Yeah. I think for this piece, I mean, I knew it was should be around, 10, 15 minutes, maybe a bit longer. It's actually a funny story. I got in, this was with another performance. I was invited to play in Strasbourg. And at some point, I don't know, maybe 1 month before the performance, I was thinking like, I wonder if this is a solo concert. Because I'm used to playing in contexts where I'm not the only person playing in the concert. So there's a sequence of different pieces by different performers. So usually pieces are, 15, 20 minutes, maybe 30 minutes. So then I was realizing, maybe I should play multiple pieces on this concert. So then I actually got, played two other pieces as well. So I played three pieces in total to make like a full length concert. And then of course I had to come up with how do I switch between these different pieces.
Yeah.
Because they all require different different software setups and also hardware setups, in the sense that like one piece I actually was performing with the laptop on my lap. This was my first live coding performance called Code Live Code Live, which was actually about the interaction with the laptop while live coding. And then the second piece I used this instrument, which is kind of a percussive instrument. I can make all these sounds on it, which is picked up with Kato's, and then I can modulate it with pressing on the different corners. And I can also record loops of sound and play it back and transform that playback. So I did one piece with this, and then I played Wezen Geworden.
All right.
I guess basically, if I would play for a full hour, I would probably change the composition. And I don't know, this is the first time I'm performing this piece. And usually there's, with each performance, I do another iteration on.
So I guess from that I would say, and I guess this makes sense, like you really think like each position is so tied to the instrument that if you do another composition, you're probably going to play a new instrument, which means you can have a new hardware controller, run some new software, just like everything kind of is reset.
Yeah. Well, I mean, in this case, I'm using the same controllers, or mostly the same. I start from the pieces with choosing like what controllers and what setup I'm using. So, in that sense, I work from the compositional concept and the stage concept.
How about you, Autumn? When you're performing during pieces, do you normally perform one piece, or if you're performing a sequence of pieces, how do you navigate going from piece to piece?
So I tend to think of my Super Collider patch as being the composition more than what I am actually performing in my shows. Like I kind of think of it as I build this patch in Super Collider, and then I have to learn how to play it. I have to learn how to, it's kind of a back and forth. I'll tweak the way that a synth works, and then I'll try it out, see how it sounds, tweak it, sort of this iterative process. But then when I'm content with that, then my live performances tend to be very improvisational. I feel like the in a way, my I front load the composition work into this, like building a patch that performs sort of intuitively the way I want, using the like the gestures that I've learned to do to control the instruments, and then the performance tends to be pretty improvisational. I have a few, like I always start out by trying to like introduce, here's how the gloves work. If I hold this finger and do this, it does, or whatever. But then, and the harp pieces obviously are memorized. Like I tend to go with harp pieces that I have played for a very long time, because I know that while I'm juggling the instruments and everything else, I need to have something that's simple enough that I can execute it, and not like in the garage piece, it was cold. My fingers were numb. And I have all these electronics on them, and I still have to be able to like execute to a level that I won't be embarrassed about. But yeah, in terms of composition, I tend to favor planning out, trying to build this thing that allows me to execute it in an intuitive way to create a kind of a kind of composition that I like the sound of.
You know, it's funny, I mean, I'm just hearing this contrast between, like, I totally get you, by the way, like, the building Super Collider patch as composition totally makes sense to me. Like, I do that all the time, and I oftentimes very much do view things like the performance is improvisation, but the composition is the software, or the composition is the sound design. But I think it's interesting, this contrast between harp pieces and non-harp pieces, you know? And maybe part of it is with the harp piece, you have a physical thing you need to interact with, which suggests organizing music materials, organizing your performance in a very specific way, dealing with strings. And whereas when you're, I don't know, I mean, is it just when you're working more gesturally, you don't have that same kind of cognitive load in terms of specific performance gestures?
So what I'd say is that my approach, the reason why I'm interested in building digital instruments, is to create this kind of physical intuitiveness of performance. Like, I want to create an instrument that makes it physically, sort of emotionally intuitive to create the kinds of sounds that I want to make out of that instrument. And the thing about the harp is that the harp is the intuitive instrument for making harp sounds, right? Like, if I tried to play harp sounds using my gloves, it would suck. It would not work. It would be like a terrible theremin. And so when I'm playing the harp, you know, the harp is the instrument where it's intuitive to play harp sounds. And so I like a lot of these very classically harp kind of things. Like I have like Dies Irae. I always use little clips of that in my little snippets of that in my performance, just because I love it. And it's, you know, ominous. And a lot of medieval harp music, because people, you know, associate it with this like ancient, you know, medieval traditions. So, yeah, I think to me, the thing about instrument design is picking the right instrument or creating the right instrument for the kind of sound that you want to make.
Nicely said. Yeah. Tristan, I thought I would chime in with you around this whole discussion about, like, how do you get from piece to piece? How much is what part of your instrument changes to deal with different pieces, or if anything, or I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, simple automation, but, you know, I feel like, unlike some of the other artists that are here, I'm playing like rock songs that were on an album. And although they change a lot, because when you write them in the studio, you go play them live and certain things. So, you know, you do compress them and change them a little bit. But I try to recreate that. And so, you know, that's a little bit more straightforward, you know, getting clips and the kind of classic Ableton clip triggering kind of methodology. Mm-hmm. I used to do things a lot more open and droney and noisy, but I think my goal was to always sort of do it in this very organized, controlled manner. I just, in the past, it was droney because I was sort of figuring it out for a few years, you know? So the idea of doing a noise performance was not really the intention. Just kind of happened that way.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's really interesting. Like, it is a slightly different context, though, how your performance come about. And I think what I like about that is it really suggests a different way of thinking about organizing things. You know, both your performance and also, like, you know, what's going on in terms of control. You are changing a lot of parameters behind the scenes. You know, so when you're interacting with your instruments, they're doing different things. But it seems like gesturally, they feel consistent.
Yeah, you know, in some ways, I would, in a perfect world, I would like to, you know, especially, you know, something Autumn said about not having a table. And, you know, a lot of these things that we design are so that we can, you know, we start out in the lab, we started out in grad school, we were coming up with this little thing, and then but then, you know, as you start to get performances at festivals and you're on these big stages, and all of a sudden that little thing is really small, you know? So how do you kind of scale this up to look interesting in those environments? And these sort of interesting gestural things that we do, all of a sudden, like, nobody has any idea what the hell you're doing up there. And so I've kind of lately sort of been looking from far away to sort of see, you know, what changes could be made to make that more interesting without, you know, faking things. And that sort of plays in. I think Autumn's in a good place there because she's got this gestural, you know, this, but, you know, maybe even that will get to the point where people won't know what she's doing. So, you know, where do you take that? You know, you get video, obviously. And anyway, I like kind of playing that out. So I feel like from far away, I just like, I'm like, you know.
Yeah, I think that's the context in which you are performing music is always really important. Having played a lot of also noise underground scenes, like there it's usual, yeah, there's tables and people put their gear on that, and you sort of have to navigate between that. And yeah,
but they're right up in your face, you know. So I like there's this performer, Lingua Ignota, who tours around, and she's a very good singer, and she has these sequences, and she gets right in your face, you know. Pharmacon would be another one, and Autumn's doing that. But you know, when that scales up and then there's a big stage, you know, you can't, in a theater of 1500 people, you can't go on the floor, you know. It's just not practical. You can do it. So then it's like you have these like stages of where do you take this, you know, to have it grow. It's kind of fun. You
know? It's fun, but at the same time, it's something that I've been thinking about because of the situations in which I've performed. And it's like, do I want to make the size and the venues that I will be playing in as part of my creative process? You know, it's like it's almost kind of a limitation that I'm not sure I want to co-opt. Is that a way to say it? Like, I'm not sure if like this is something that I'm comfortable putting into my design principles, you know. It has to be seen from like the back of the stage, and like there's something in me that's like is it still, you know, create, like, is it still a craft? Am I still crafting it if I'm thinking about like the big show context? And it's, yeah, I just wanted to comment on it because it's something that I've always been in a kind of like push and pull situation when I design my instruments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do you want to become like a Burning Man kind of prop, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead.
No, it's also like if you play like in festival context and stuff, you really have to put a strong point in saying like, well, I need the stage to be like this. Depending on what sort of musical context you're playing in, this can be really hard to actually get. I like this, yeah, with my performances lately, I like these very minimal setups where there's nothing on the stage and it's just a tiny laptop somewhere and me performing. And it's really hard to get that because everyone else has so much gear and the short changeover times, et cetera. And, and that's a really hard thing to negotiate sometimes. To have the setup that you need. So in that sense, bringing big stuff yourself, you are already taking that space. But if you want open space, that's a lot harder, maybe. I don't know. It was kind of funny when you said, "Oh, this one, it's actually really small," and I think it's the biggest of the instruments that or maybe Autumn's were larger. But I found that, playing with something that's just on my hands, that was a really funny comment for me.
Yeah, sorry.
There's another element, like coming back to, I guess, like the initial question about like how to structure a whole performance or time within a performance. I guess a thought that came to my mind was like the fact that I try to use different aspects of the interface to structure the timeline. So like in Ballistics, for example, I start with only handheld gestures, so that when I finally use like the like larger pendulum motion, it comes in a bit as a surprise, and then like there's a section based on that. And then more like towards the end, I'll use a bit more like the downward beams. So like it's like a whole other session. So yeah, I thought like, so like the visual aspects of the interface also will serve in a way to structure the scenographic, I guess, aspect will serve to use, to structure the whole thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's, I gotta say, I think that's incredibly effective. Like I was watching your performance with my friend who did my videography, and we were watching you with the handheld. And then when they started swinging, we were like, that's the coolest thing ever. Like it's a really, I think a really effective way of like structuring your performance, because it just, like you think you know what it is, and then it's like, no, it's this other thing too. And that just is incredibly cool. Like I loved your performance. It was mind blowing.
Thanks a lot. But also like in those contexts, like the venue and the size of the venue matters so much, because in smaller venues, I can literally go towards people and shine the lights directly in their face. And like when I do the first pendulum motion, I do it towards the audience. And like, it's really like for people, it's really shocking, because I measure it so that it comes like just above the head of people in the room. But I obviously cannot really do that if it's a really large venue, because it's like, well, it's the impact is completely lost. So,
Yeah.
I've never actually performed with an audience with the robot arms yet, because I finished them around this time last year. And so obviously there hasn't been very much live performance. And I'm curious to see what's going to happen when I do, because mostly I'm in these really small, you know, noise underground venues, and those things have a wingspan of about 6 feet to the sides and like 3 feet back. And I like to like go out into the audience, and like now what am I can't hit anybody in the face. Like I've hit myself in the face with the robot, but I don't want to hit anybody else in the face with the robot. We'll see how that works out. That'll be an adventure.
Yeah, that's another fun part, like civil insurance. And I'm not sure how it's called, like civil responsibility. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think a lot about that. Your first responsibility is not to injure the performers or the audience.
Yeah, I love that video of Survival Research Laboratories when they're like, oh, I got hit in the eye with a BB. And they're like all having the best time of their lives. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, I want to open things up a little bit just for... you know, anyone to ask a question, anything that they want to know. This is sort of our last chance to sort of, you know, dig in. So I'm just going to open it up.
So I have a question. We've heard about the inspirations for, I think, Tristan and Autumn, well, sound design inspirations, you know, it being like some kind of media. I was curious as to what the sound design inspirations for Miriam and Maria were.
Shall I go first?
Sure.
Yeah, so I think for this piece, I actually reused some sound design I did for the previous piece. So I don't know if there's any explicit sort of inspiration for that sound design.
It's kind of like sound masses, right? Some of it, at
yeah,
least.
So, but I don't know if I have any explicit like examples of other artists that I can say like, oh, I'm trying to do what this artist is doing. Sort of in the control and of starting and stopping, I'm using influences from actually from a lot of the case studies of and work that I've encountered while working on the book. So I'm using concepts from Rosa and Fluck with this flicking motion and this pose detection that Kathy Van Eyck is doing, and also Rosa and Fluck are doing. And this concept that Jeff Carey is talking about, where he says, like, well, you using data first to set starting parameters and also for real-time control of parameters, so making a distinction between those, or the combination of those. Yeah, so there's all these different concepts in how I'm mapping things and how I'm using things, and of course the Lick machine, which was developed by Michel Weiss together with Frank Baudet. So this concept of recording control data and then playing that back and modulating it and filtering things out. Yeah, playing it back faster, slower, small sections of it. And then, just layering sound on top of each other. To create bigger masses of sound.
Mm-hmm. I guess, like, for the visual aspect of ballistics, for example, like, I mean, for Soft Revolvers, it was a bit different because I was just like out of my jazz guitar trip. So I was listening to a lot of hip hop, and I was like in a hip hop band. And since, like, it's all sample based, it has a like pretty specific vibe to it. I guess around that time I was listening a lot to Markfell, so like the change in like tempo and the way that it relates to the speed of the spinning tops, that was really influential for me, and also Atom TM, Uwe Schmidt. So yeah, like the kind of more plasticky kind of sounds. And then for ballistics, I guess like visually, I was not that familiar with David Rudnick's, like the designer David Rudnick's work back then, but I guess like it was kind of in, like, yeah, it like for me, I really see that kind of influence, like a mix of like science fiction, like dark background with like, sharp colors, but for the laser projector, for example. And for that sound design, like I was starting to do a lot more Super Glider and being more interested in sound design work. So I guess around that time I was listening to a lot of, who was I listening to? I don't know, like Onatrix But Never, like a bit like sci-fi, like Lanark Artifacts, and what's the other one I wanted? Like Jesse Osborne-Lantier, which is also from Montreal. So I was listening a bit more to that kind of stuff. And there's a definite like influence from like horror movies kind of vibes in that performance as well. Like it's much more in like hits and like explosions rather than like kind of a smooth like maintaining processes or like melodies or chordal progressions. So yeah, it's more about the impacts and then like creating kind of masses around that. Yeah. So, but right now I'm somewhere else. I'm doing modular and I'm. I'm not really into that anymore, so yeah.
I'll keep leave it open for more questions.
Does anyone have questions in the YouTube chat? I'm not on there.
The YouTube chat has been pretty quiet. We've had one person sort of chiming in every so often. The last thing I think they made was back when we were talking about things crashing. This thing, you know, things going wrong is part of the performance. I think what they actually said is part of the performance, arrow crash. Sounds about right.
Maybe actually, Ian, you can say something about more about your instrument and how you were composing for it.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking about that as you and Miriam were talking about your influences. You know, I definitely explicitly was thinking about Ryoji Ikeda, who I love, and Grace also loves and often brings in Ryoji Ikeda stuff. He's so great. And then I also mentioned a lot of Robert Ikey Aubrey Lowe. I almost tried to do a cover of Robert Aubrey Ikey Lowe, who's a modular musician. He's fantastic. But doing a cover is not easy, right? So I thought about it, and then I thought, you know, that sounds like it'd be too hard to do. So a lot about kind of texture in that way. I mean, the whole thing about like FM feedback, sort of like sound masses, that's sort of like very easy. Like that's something that feels very comfortable, and the kind of exploring kind of like the instability of those kinds of feedback systems, which is the first part of this of the piece. And then the second piece, that thing about, you know, kind of like layering rhythms. I think a lot about rhythm, not just in terms of like onsets, but also in terms of timbral variations, and the feel and the sort of the character of the rhythmic sounds and how that changes the rhythmic feel as you combine parts. So I think that was a large part of it too. Well, this has been. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I have a question, sort of based on that, for everybody. I'm curious if anybody has used their custom instruments ever to try and do a cover of something, because I've thought about that a lot and I've never done it, and it seems a little intimidating.
I think Tristan might be like, I'd be curious, like somebody else's music. Is it possible?
Yeah. I've got a cover on the new album coming out that's like a Portishead track. Played at like half the BPM or something, but it's fun to do. If you use the keyboard, it's very easy, you know. But if you use the pitch bends and you cover something that kind of makes it more atonal and dissonant. I've tried to, this band, the Melvins, I've done a cover of one of their songs, which is really fun because they're a heavy band, but then I just kind of mush it together and take it even more into the realm of like dissonance. Kind of just, you know, it's like taking a clown song and, you know, pitch bending it and making it sound even worse. That's kind of my goal usually.
I've never tried to do that, but it just made me think about, I don't know if you guys know Eva Jiska. She creates like her own kind of little modular boards, but they're not only a Euro rack. Sometimes they have like really crazy shape, like just like the PCBs. And, you know, she's hilarious. And like her music is generally very noisy and like kind of garage feel. And she's done these like covers of classical music, like Prokofiev, whatever. It just made me think about that. And I think it's really cool and hilarious to do those kinds of cross things between, unexpected covers. Yeah.
Yeah,
I think the closest I've come to doing a cover was actually also a conceptual piece, because at some point I got interested in trying to live code being away from the laptop. So I got this one-handed Twiddler, which is a one-handed keyboard. And then I had to learn how to type. So I created this piece called Etude pour le live coding à humain. So, and in that work, I take the transcript from a live coded performance from someone else and I try to replay it. Mm. Then I added, I mean, it's all about playing this etude on stage, so and setting the scene in a sort of classical music setup. I put on a little jacket and look all nice, and then basically I add lights. So if I type correctly, it's a green light. If I type wrong, it's a red light, and so on. So then basically the performance is trying to re-live code that piece.
You need to have a jury or something like that on stage, right? Like writing little notes on their clipboards.
Yeah, well, it brought up a lot of interesting questions, like do I have to make the same mistakes as the original performer? Mm-hmm. Because there's really this moment where you see he's making this mistake and he's trying to recover from it. And having rehearsed this many, many times, this sort of aspect of live coding completely changes.
You know, it's funny, it's making me think of a piece that Family did. We did a cover of David Tudor's Rainforest 4. And I guess I was thinking about this because when talking about doing a cover of certain kind of music, especially like experimental improvisational music or music where they're using, you know, creating systems, like the system itself is so much the composition. Like if you were to recreate the system and then just play a piece of music, like, is that a cover? And that's really what this sort of Rainforest 4 piece that we did. It was very actually loosely based on David Tudor's original piece. It was a feedback piece with, you know, transducers on objects in the world and then sending contact microphones and sort of sending audio around a network. But in a way, like, I think that makes a lot of sense. Like Autumn was saying, you know, so much of the composition is in the system design. If you recreate Michelle Weisfies's web, you know, like that's going to suggest a certain way of making music. Like, is that a cover? What's something that I always want to do is to recreate that web instrument. It's really beautiful. But it's a different kind of cover than things that are more tightly structured, of course. Well, it is, you know, definitely after 4 o'clock, we should really wrap up. I want to thank everybody so much for being part of this. It's so fun. The concert last night was amazing. It's great to get a chance to hear everybody's perspectives and a lot of really interesting discussions that I think that will be food for a lot of thought in the future as well.
Thanks for organizing this and putting this great lineup together.
Sure. And I'm glad you all got to meet each other, right? This is a part of the community.
Yeah.
And I really like that part of it as well. Yeah.
Hopefully we can see each other in person someday.
I know, right?
Someday.
Well, when I first was organizing this concert, it was going to be an in-person concert. And I was just thinking to myself, like, how different would this have been? You know, we had like a $500 budget for travel or something like that. Like, yeah. So in a way this worked out well.
I'm just wondering if I may ask, like, where are you based, Autumn and Tristan? Like,
I'm in San Diego.
Okay.
Los Angeles.
Cool.
Yeah.
I'm in Montreal. You're in Montreal. I don't think I mentioned it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm in Amsterdam, so it's actually almost 10:30 here.
Yeah.
Wow.
And John is in Montreal, but not for long.
As well.
Is that right?
I'm still here. I'm moving to Little Italy, which is like
2 kilometers
down the road.
I saw your Kijiji posting, so.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, no, we just bought a condo down the street, so.
Oh, nice. Awesome.
That's it. I mean, I'm finished the PhD. Job applications are going out, so who knows where I'll end up long term, but still here for a while.
Cool. Well, I wish I could come back and live in Montreal. It's a fantastic place. So was LA, but I spent enough time in LA. cool. Well, great to see everyone. Have a great rest of your day.
I will be
in touch just to wrap up loose ends and everything like that. But this has been a really fantastic experience. And thanks to everybody from the class for coming and hanging out. I hope it was fun for you as well.
Yeah.
And Preston, who did a lot of work behind the scenes to make all this happen. And you all have been in touch with him as well. So great. All right, everybody. Take care.
Great. Thank you, Ian.
Thank you.